You're watching Orbit ESPN.
ESPN and ESPN2, your home for America's pastime.
Minute Maid Park in Houston, Texas. MVP candidates Albert Pujols and Lance Berkman clash in a huge September series for the Astros and Cardinals. Now, Houston took game one, beating the Cardinals 6-3 last night, so St. Louis sees the lead cut to 5.5. Houston 4.5 out in the wild card race, and the Astros cannot afford a single slip up with the Cardinals, or it could be over for them. Hi, everybody. Very pleasant Friday evening. Dave O'Brien along with my partner, Rick Sutcliffe. Thanks so much for joining us. And Sut, matters get very critical now for the Houston club. They have 6 left head-to-head with St. Louis, and that's huge because they're only 15 games left on the schedule anyway for them.
Yeah, but it's really a different Houston Astro ball club right now than the team the Cardinals played in April and May. They gained a lot of confidence with that big victory. They didn't expect to win that ball game last night. But what they do expect is to play better down the stretch, and they like the schedule. Reason being, they've got 3 more here against the Cardinals, 3 in St. Louis, and then the Cardinals have the toughest 3-game series the National League has to offer. They're playing the world champs, the Arizona Diamondbacks, with Curt Schilling and Randy Johnson scheduled to pitch.
St. Louis, by the way, 9-4 against the Astros head-to-head this season. They're going to be sending out, the Cardinals are, Jason Simontacchi. A very surprising season for the rookie. But when you want to talk about eye-popping numbers from a young pitcher, you start with Roy Oswalt of the Houston Astros. Tonight, going for his 20th win, he has to be the best pitcher in the game that not many people know much about.
Well, do you remember when it was Roy Oswalt?
Yeah.
Well, now that he has gotten things right on the mound, we're getting his name right. And what he's gotten right is in his 50 career big league starts, he has won 33 of those ball games. A fastball in the low 90s. The difference is the curveball in the low 70s. The difference in that velocity can flat out embarrass big league hitters.
Well, his former manager, Larry Durker, said he's going to win a Cy Young one day. Probably not this year for the 25-year-old, but he has been magnificent. Of course, on the other side of the diamond, he has a tough task getting out this man, Albert Pujols, the number 2 RBI man in the National League with 115. But the Astros have the number 1 RBI guy, Lance Berkman, on their side, 119 driven in. They'll slug it out in Houston coming up next.
ESPN's Major League Baseball, brought to you by FedEx. Ground, international, online, or express. Don't worry, there's a FedEx for that.
Coming up tonight on Friday Night Baseball, in Sut's soapbox, Rick sheds light on why a veteran catcher is so important to a young pitcher like Roy Oswalt. The National League RBI race could come down to these Cardinal-Astros games in the end. Who outdoes who? And Sut will be chatting with the pride of Texas, Lance Berkman, a college star at Rice, an all-star at Houston, and fast becoming a superstar. A lot of superstars in Tony La Russa's lineup. Let's get right to them. And we key on Scott Rolen, 24 homers, 96 RBIs, and Sut. He's been productive as a Cardinal since the trade, 28 RBIs in his last 30 games.
Well, he's also scored 22 runs in those last 30 games. He brings that gold glove defense with him every night. But the key to him is the fact that he has provided protection for that guy in front of him, Albert Pujols.
Pujols with 115 RBIs. Roy Oswalt will try and beat them. And if he does, it'll be his 20th win of the year. He has literally been perfect over his last 9 starts with a 1.22 ERA. He's won all 9.
You know what? But that's nothing new to him. Last year, in his rookie year with just 14 victories, he had 2 separate streaks where he won 6 straight ball games. He expects to win every time out.
Number 5 in ERA in the National League, top 5 in innings, wins, and strikeouts. And Here defensively are the Houston Astros and Brad Ausmus. We talked about the importance of the veteran catcher. He won the Gold Glove last year, may win another one this year.
Well, I think he will. It's been his overall best year of his whole career. He's got a great rapport with the home plate umpires, which a lot of time is overlooked. Look at the nice low target that he gives all of his pitchers. Just a terrific year for the Houston Astro veteran.
He's already got Charlie Relliford, the home plate umpire, grinning about something. And that will pay some dividends, perhaps, for the right-hander Oswalt. Fernando Vena to dig in, and we are set to go inside Minute Maid Park. And you know how big Friday night football is for the high school kids and the fans here in Texas. That has eaten into our crowd a little bit, despite the very significant importance of this game. First pitch is in there for strike one. Perhaps a late arriving crowd, but football is still king in Texas and probably always will be. The new pro team, the Houston Texans, in this city. They've got everybody chatting. That one flying toward the alley. Ward can't quite get it. It scoots on by him, and it's up against the fence. Hunter will dig it out, and it's a quick double for Fernando Vena, who has now hit in seven in a row.
You know, he's not your typical leadoff type guy. Work the count, you know, get a lot of pitchers out of the starting pitcher, get on base, steal a bag. But he finds a way to get it done. And here he picks on arguably the weakest part of the Houston Astro defense, that being Darryl Ward in left field, not able to not only get to that ball but cut it off. The runner in scoring position right off the bat.
So J.D. Drew steps in at 264. He's hit 15 home runs, but he's hitting over 300 in his last eight ball games. He takes a soft breaking ball in there for a strike.
Eli Marrero was in the lineup last night in right field, but J.D. Drew with a pinch hit off a 98-mile-an-hour fastball by Octavio Dotel kind of caught the eyes of Tony La Russa, got him in the lineup.
Bounces that one up there, one ball and one strike. Now, Drew has already caught the eye of the Astros. You go back to May, he beat him twice with game-winning hits in back-to-back games.
You want to know why we highlighted Brad Ausmus? Take a look at this. That ball bounced in front of home plate, yet absolutely smothered. Why is that important? Well, the man on second and nobody out, move him up 90 feet, he's going to score easily.
One and two now on Drew. Jim Edmonds up next, and then Albert Pujols.
You know, as a young pitcher, you throw that ball in the dirt. With a lot of catchers, you go, whoa, I can't do that again. Well, with Brad Ausmus, I mean, you go, yeah, I can. It's not going to get by him, and more times than not, it doesn't.
Vena at second base, nobody out. A swing and a high deep drive, but foul. Way off to the right and into the second level at Minute Maid Park. It's a club deep, but in the wrong direction by J.D. Drew.
Talking to Jeff Bagwell this morning, he says J.D. Drew just absolutely kills us. He says, I don't care if he's injured, if he's had a wrist injury or a knee injury, normally both with J.D., he says he finds a way to wear us out. He just about did there.
Oswalt usually a very quick worker but deliberate with men on base. A swing and a miss, and he fans Drew. So not that time. He can't eat up the Astros staff in this at bat. One down as Oswalt strikes him out.
Well, first of all, again, the confidence in Ausmus with the ball down to keep in front of him. But that breaking ball was clocked at 71 miles an hour. I mean, nobody has the kind of disparity between velocities on the fastball and that curveball that this kid already does.
As Drew found out, Oswalt can be very difficult to be productive against in the first inning of games. But here's Jim Edmonds. He gets brushed back a little bit, and you can see that throughout this series happening because Edmonds has been crushing Houston all year.
Good morning. Huh? Let's go, big boy. I know you like to dive and extend. Let's see if you continue to try that.
26 home runs, and six of them have come against Houston. Batting 383 against the Astros this year. No matter the name of the park, and it's gone by three different names, Enron Field, Astros Field, and now Minute Maid Park, Edmonds loves to hit here. 421 in this baseball park.
I know I'm going to drop an Enron at some point in the game tonight.
Swing and a miss, and it got to him. Doesn't matter what you call it. 97 miles an hour on that fastball. You talked about the changeup at 71 miles an hour. You see the Minute Maid folks putting their stamp on the park, but that's a difference in 26 miles an hour.
You know, and there's a different feel on this ballpark now. They thought it was totally a hitter's park to begin with. That's not the case right now. It is if you look at the boxes. All right, down the left field line and down the right field line. But out there with that gas pump right out there in left center field, that's a long ways to hit the ball out in that area. And then center field is just absolutely ridiculous.
436 to dead center. Up over Towles Hill out there, where Lance Berkman made a memorable catch earlier this season, running right up that grassy knoll there.
You know, it's really difficult to play that center field. Plus, they've also enlarged this park. You can see there above the Cardinal bullpen where the yellow stripe for the home run has been raised. It used to be right above there, right above the dugout. And they raised that up now. What is that, another 10, 15 feet?
They've taken some home runs away. Down and in over the shoe tops of Edmonds. Pujols to hit next. A man at second, one away, and a full count on the number three hitter. So Edmonds trying to pick up what would be his 78th RBI. He's been cool here in the month of September, just a 206 batting average. And the way the Astros are trying to breathe down St. Louis's neck, they need him to get hot again. Pops this one up, but back out of play. The Cardinals have been in first place for 86 consecutive days. Yet they own the fewest wins of the six division leaders with an 84-62 record. Last night, Houston snapped their eight-game winning streak with a 6-3 decision.
I think the Cardinals and Tony La Russa have saved the best for last. They are playing by far their best baseball of the year right now. They're getting healthy with Matt Morris and Woody Williams back, and they've really got a lot of momentum going into the end of this season.
Looking for a first inning run here to establish some momentum. There's ball four to Edmonds on a close pitch. It did not go Oswalt's way, and that'll put runners at first and second with one down. And Jimmy Williams certainly would have loved that call. It's ball four.
Well, I guess that relationship we talked about between home plate umpire Charlie Relliford and Brad Ausmus isn't as good as it originally looked like. That ball's got to be called a strike.
Pretty good pitch. That's a pitcher's pitch.
Well, and this is already a pitcher on the mound. Oswalt just turned 25 years of age this year, and you can see the command. That has been helped a lot by Brad Ausmus with the pitch selection.
So now Oswalt has to face Albert Pujols, and all he's done this year is hit .313 with 32 homers, 115 RBIs. He's hit in seven in a row, and he's the top RBI man in the National League since the All-Star break. He's driven in 49 of those runs since the break. Two on, one out, and it's under the chin. Oswalt showing he is not concerned about coming inside on anybody.
You know, you can talk about the Dodgers and the Giants and the Yankees and the Red Sox, and at one time what was the Cardinals and the Cubs in that rivalry. This one has come a long ways in a short period of time because these teams are so evenly matched.
Now last year was St. Louis roaring from behind in the late stages of the season. Big bender in there for a strike. And they wound up forcing their way into the playoffs, largely at the expense of the Astros.
About the fact, I mean, there's one thing having a good breaking ball. There's another thing being able to pitch with it. Behind in the count, being able to throw it for a strike, and then when you're ahead in the count, expand in that zone.
Foul back, it's a ball and two strikes on Pujols, who's hitting .348 with men in scoring position. That's how you drive in 115 runs. MVP kind of season.
I mean, I don't think the MVP vote is going to be real close. But, I mean, Bonds is just in another league by himself. But if it weren't for Bonds.
1-2, another breaking ball popped into right, but short. Berkman with a long run in, but time to get there. And Oswalt gets by Edmonds and Pujols in different ways. He put Edmonds on. But he gets the toughest RBI man on that team to pop it up, and they're two gone.
Tell you what, though, because of what Fernando Viña did, hitting that leadoff double, putting the pressure on every single pitch from this point on for Oswalt, this will be the 20th pitch already of this inning. There's a difference between 20 pitches where you're cruising and you're taking a little off, adding a little bit on. Every one of these have been maximum effort, and that can take its toll. You get to the sixth, seventh inning.
Here's Scott Rolen, who's hit 24 home runs on the year. First ball swinging, and he just fouls it down the left field line. Just to the wrong side of that bag. Otherwise, it's a bases clearing double.
I don't know who the guy was that did it, but somebody's covered up that hole on the inside part of the plate. Whether it be Tony La Russa or the hitting coach Mitchell Page, you used to be able to just knock the bat out of Scott Rolen's hands with a good fastball on the inside part of the plate. He's covered that hole.
Two on and a fly to right field, and Oswalt's going to get out of the inning without any trouble. Berkman handles it. End of the inning. Two men left. He gave up the leadoff double to Viña, but stranded him out there at second base. He's on his way to 20 wins. No scores. We go to the bottom of the first. Jimmy Williams, the first-year skipper of the Houston Astros, has his team in the race, but they probably have to sweep this series. They took game one last night, and here's his starting lineup. Biggio at second base, Bagwell at first. Of course, they are the old war horses. And Bagwell, the 94 MVP, tearing it up, Rick, here in September. He's hitting .432 for the month.
You know, it's amazing he's been able to do it, too, with just basically one arm. He had shoulder surgery last year in the offseason, may possibly need it again, but he's just doing things in his career that nobody else in the history of baseball has done offensively.
He's up against the right-hander Simontacchi, and despite his status as the Cardinals' second winningest pitcher behind Matt Morris, he was recently sent to AAA, then they brought him back. He's coming off a 3-1 win over the Cubs, 8 terrific innings for him.
Kind of the comeback player of the year twice this year.
Yeah, right.
Think about how far he's come from playing in the Italian League, then he gets sent back to the minor leagues. Woody Williams and Matt Morris telling me before tonight's game, the big difference in him now is the fact that he's not overwhelmed with all of his success. He has more confidence in himself as a pitcher now.
29-year-old out of Mountain View, California, and bidding for his 11th win of the year, and a win that just might end any thoughts of going to the playoffs for the Houston Astros. That's how important this game and this series is. Brian Hunter to lead things off. He's hitting .291 with a couple of homers, and he's driven in 15 runs, and then it's Biggio and Berkman here in the first inning. Simontacchi fires in a knee-high strike. It's 1-1. The Astros a little bit like the Oakland A's, only on a smaller scale in terms of personality. They tend to get very, very hot in the second half, and they're playing very well right now. They've won 14 of their last 17 games to pull to within 5.5 of the Cardinals. They were 8 games back in mid-July when they were 4 games under .500, but they got it together. At one point, they pulled within 1 game of first place. That was on August 7th. It was the closest they had been since April 5th. Last year, they were a .500 club in mid-June and then went 59-36 the rest of the way to win the division.
Well, that was just a completely different looking lineup last year. They had some power 1-7.
3-2.
It's not so much there anymore as it was. You take away Moises Alou, Vinny Castilla, that's 50 homers and about 190 RBIs last year. They had to figure out what kind of team they were, and it took them a while to get that done. They know now.
The payoff from Simontacchi, hammered into left center field. Hunter's a flyer, but he'll settle for a lengthy single to get started for the Astros. Now defensively for the St. Louis Cardinals, and particularly when you look around the infield, it might be take your pick. If you want a gold glove, you might be able to go to any
those spots. That's a huge strength for this ball club. No question, the best infield in the National League, possibly the best defensive infield in all of baseball. And they also can do some things offensively.
Edgar Renteria, if they really had just one guy who is a lead pipe cinch to win it, it might be him. But they don't make a lot of errors, and they turn a bunch of double plays. Only two teams in the National League have turned more twin killings. And so Biggio steps up. and fouls one away. He's hitting 263 with 14 home runs.
I'd say up to this point right now, the biggest hit of the year for the Astros. Last night, off Dave Fears, eighth inning, down by one run. The crowd was just quiet. The bullpen for Tony La Russa just shutting down the offense of Houston until one swing of the bat, he tied that game. And eventually, in that same eighth inning, they took the lead and got the victory.
He was 2-for-3 in that win. And Craig needs a big series. He's hitting 238 here in the month of September. And of course, he, along with Jeff Bagwell, synonymous with the name Houston Astros. After all these years, and all those unwashed helmets. Hunter with terrific speed, not running, and it hits him. And that also is as old as Craig Biggio in a Houston Astros uniform. Getting hit, he does it a lot. That's the 17th time this year. In fact, he's third on the all-time list.
Really an off year in that department for Craig Biggio. Last year with 28, he led the league, as he's done many times. And he's not going to give a whole lot. He'll take a look out at the mound. But deep down, he said, hey, you hit me all you want. All I'm trying to do tonight is get on base for the big boys. And the biggest one this year standing at home plate.
I don't know if he'll catch Don Baylor, but there's Ron Hunt a little bit closer right in front of him. That's not one of those when you're an eight-year-old little leaguer. You're dreaming in the backyard of one day breaking that record.
You know what, though? Craig Biggio might have.
Yeah, he might have. You're right. Now, he might be the only exception.
He's just that kind of kid.
I bet he got hit all the time in Little League. He was getting plunked left and right. He still has the face of a Little Leaguer. So two on, nobody out, and here's Lance Berkman, the top RBI man in the National League with 119. You add in the 296 average and the 40 home runs, it's been a spectacular year for him. Big shift on for him.
Not to take anything at all away from him, but I think that he hits in the best spot in all of baseball for the last 10 years. Biggio in front of you, the top 10, 100 already in runs scored, and Bagwell behind you.
Hunter and Biggio get their leads, and it's fouled away. Berkman with a pretty good cut. He's hitting 363 with men in scoring position. And that's second to Craig Counsell, who of course is out for the season. Unfortunately for the Arizona Diamondbacks, and they're going to have to go on and win another world championship if they do without him.
Well, Luis Gonzalez just told me a few days ago that we lost our MVP. Talking about Counsell.
The 0-2 from Simontacchi down low and stopped by DeFelice. Berkman, 119 runs batted in, and Rick Sutcliffe talked to him before the game around the batting cage. And some terrific stuff and stories and information coming from him. You'll hear it throughout our broadcast. But he puts so much pressure on himself to drive in runs. He says, that's what they pay me to do. I feel like I fail if I don't come through in situations just like this. He was 0-for-4 in game one. But the Astros won anyway. 2-2. On deck, Jeff Bagwell.
You can just see the calm about him in these approaches. A lot of young hitters with runners in scoring position act like 16-year-olds when they learn to drive 55 miles an hour. Look at the bat just resting there.
Missed inside, but a pretty good pitch by Simontacchi. 3-2.
Another thing that even Jeff Bagwell talks about that amazes you about young Lance Berkman is for a power hitter, his knowledge of the strike zone. And he said that's only going to get better.
Runners lead, and sucked into right field for a base hit. Hunter on his way to third. Drew gets it in quickly, and the bases will be loaded. So no RBI this time for Berkman. But he hit it hard, and now they're loaded up for Bagwell. Nobody out in the first inning, and a huge game for Houston.
Craig
Biggio knew that this was going to be a base hit because he was closer to it. Brian Hunter didn't. Watch Brian Hunter freeze right there. The reason he froze is because in that loss in Milwaukee a couple of days ago, he got thrown out trying to stretch a double into a triple. That was a bad move with the Astros being down as far as they were. He makes up for it here. Good heads-up base running. Going with him loaded, nobody out in Bagwell up. Something's going to happen.
Simontacchi's first pitch swung on and missed by Bagwell, who checks in at 293, 30 homers, 94 runs batted in. For the future Hall of Famer, all 12 years have been spent here in Houston. And has now hit 379 home runs. He is tied with Hall of Famers Tony Perez and Orlando Cepeda on the all-time list. One ball and one strike.
Well, he's far from being done. Just 34 years of age, just recently signed a multi-year deal with the Astros so that he can finish his career here where he should.
That could be many years down the road. He pokes that one foul, and now he's behind 1-2.
0-for-3 and just a few at-bats against Simontacchi. Jason's best pitch is that changeup. Right now, Jeff Bagwell just not being able to pick it up as Lance Berkman did in that last at-bat.
Bagwell in September, though, it's been a very good month for him. 432 the batting average. He's hit 5 home runs and they're all loaded up. 2-2. Nice stop by DeFelice to keep everyone at bay. Still nothing here, and DeFelice will have a word with Simontacchi.
The Cardinals have a lot of this. That's outstanding defensive catchers as well. DeFelice smothering that ball. Look at that. There's absolutely no chance for that ball to go anywhere. Mike Matheny, former Gold Glove winner, right along with that.
Simontacchi has thrown 18 pitches in the first. He hasn't gotten an out yet. And Bagwell will extend him here. St. Louis had a chance. They had runners at first and second in the top of the inning with one out. Could not score. But nobody out here. The bases jammed for the Astros in their half of the first.
One of the reasons Mike Matheny might not be in the lineup tonight, he took a beating last night. Chuck Finley on his game, bouncing a lot of split-finger fastballs, blocked by Matheny.
On the inside corner, got him looking for strike three. Simontacchi drilled it in there. 89 miles an hour, he snuck it under Bagwell's hands. That's a big first out.
Bagwell's not happy, the crowd's not happy. To me, that looks a lot like the pitch thrown to Jim Edmonds in the top of the first inning by Oswalt that was called a ball. That one's called strike three, and a huge pitch in a big spot by Jason Simontacchi.
So now Simontacchi, if he induces a double play out of Darryl Ward, frees himself from the inning without a run being scored. Now you can see the look on Bagwell's face. A lot of that is disgust at himself in a situation he's cashed in on so many times. Simontacchi made a heck of a pitch. Ward at 278, 9 home runs. Bases loaded up. And the first pitch is across for a strike.
His velocity has gotten better as this year has gone on. He was an 85 to 87 guy when we first saw him. That last pitch was 91 miles an hour. Down.
One pitch too low, a ball and a strike. Hunter at third, Biggio at second, and Berkman at first. As the Astros in pursuit of the St. Louis Cardinals try and jump out in front. Game two of this series, a series the Astros probably have to sweep.
Look at that infield. That's not so much about Darryl Ward, but about the changeup of the Cardinal pitcher.
And a big shift on, and that's outside. Another change up there, and the count goes to 2-1.
Tony La Russa and Dave Duncan have long been great communicators. And Duncan passing along the information that the pitcher is going to take to the mound with him. And then Tony La Russa and his staff setting up their defense accordingly. Well, he'd like to have had that change up for a strike, open for that ground ball.
Ward hits it toward that chip, but through for a base hit. That was the changeup again. Hunter is in to score, and it's 1-0 Houston. A Martinez jumping back afterward, couldn't quite tag him out. And it's an RBI single for Darryl Ward. And again, he went to that changeup well, but this time Ward was on it.
Boy, they had everything set up. Simontacchi makes the pitch. The ball was hit hard, but fortunately for Houston, not at anybody. Getting through the right side of that infield. You know the strength of J.D. Drew's right arm. Third base coach Gene Lamont had to put the brakes on with Craig Biggio, but Brian Hunter easily touching home plate.
Well, the Cardinals had three infielders stacked up on the right side, but Ward was able to shoot it through there. That's a frustrating run.
That's how hard he hit that ball.
Yeah, frustrating for the Cardinals. Mark Loretta now, former Brewer, now with Houston. And boy, has he ever hit well since being acquired from Milwaukee on August 31st. He's gone 14 for 35, hitting .400 as an Astro. So pretty good pickup there by Houston. A run in, one out, bases loaded. One ball and one strike on Loretta.
Be motivated too if I'm from a team that was 51 and 95 coming into tonight's play to a team that was in contention as the Astros are.
Biggio at third base, Berkman at second, Ward with the RBI single at first. Up foul, he just got a piece of it. The man on deck is Jose Vizcaino, and he was the hero of last night's Astros win. He had a big home run.
And you know who Craig Biggio said the hero was last night? Not him for tying the game up, but Mark Loretta. Loretta with two outs battled and battled and finally created a base on balls with Mike Crudell leading to the at-bat to Vizcaino and the three-run homer and the victory.
Well, you can just sense by the pace of this first inning, the deliberate nature of both pitchers with men on, how vitally important the game is for both clubs. 1-2 popped up on the infield. Infield fly in effect, and Vina there to clinch it. Two down. So not this time for Loretta.
This could be a huge momentum swing for the Cardinals. Simontacchi can get out of this. Houston, even though they would have the lead, would have to be disappointed with just one run.
Well, Vizcaino will try and change that ending to the inning. He's hitting .312, five homers, 35 RBI, so not a lot of RBI production, but he often hits low in the order or up top, and Vizcaino hitting .338 with runners in scoring position. And he said he learned as his days with the New York Yankees to drive in runs. Martinez feeds the pitcher for out number three, so not this time for him. And the Astros settled for just one run. Pretty good work by Simontacchi to give up just the one. That's our score after an inning. One inning has come and gone in this key game in the Central Division. The Astros with a 1-0 lead, but they had three hits in the first inning. They seem to have the bases loaded for a half an hour against Jason Simontacchi. He did not buckle. Tino Martinez lead off the second. Lines a slicer, and Ward comes in to make the catch. Although well struck, Tino is retired. Run away. Now in between innings, let's take a look inside the dugout.
I'll tell you what, I loved it. Jason right away goes to pitching coach Dave Duncan. Well, what about, I gave up a run. What did I do wrong? You didn't do anything wrong, kid. That ground ball just found a hole. You continue to get ground balls, you're going to continue to get outs and win this ball game.
Edgar Renteria, the hitter, he stings one down the line and just foul off that chalk line. Rick, you're amazing. You're very gifted as a lip reader. It's incredible that you could piece together that entire conversation word for word like that. And I know that's exactly what they said.
Well, there were a few things in there I couldn't repeat, though, because he was talking about Darryl Ward being a little lucky. But right after Simontacchi got done with Duncan, to his credit, he went to Woody Williams. Just saying, you see anything different? You know, I got myself in a little bit of trouble. Well, you got yourself out of it, kid. Hold him there.
Oswalt did the same thing in his part of the first inning, giving up a double, walking a man, but no run. So together, Oswalt and Simontacchi threw 50-some-odd pitches, but very gritty pitches, because they were pitching with men on throughout their innings. Foul tip to the catcher's mitt. 1-2 on Renteria.
Had to be frustrating for the Cardinals last night. All of the hits that they got, and only three runs, two hits by
Vina, Edmonds, Pujols, Rowland, and even Tino. So Finley with a great start.
Fastball, strike three. Right across the knees. Second K in the book for Oswalt. He fans Renteria.
He's got his eyes set on that 10th straight decision and his 20th victory of the year. And he knows. I was talking with him and Wade Miller before the game. They've got to be perfect the rest of the way for the Astros to have a chance. They were completely out of it, having a losing record in each of the first 3 months. Got themselves back in it. They're in the right division to do that, and they got a chance.
So a couple of strikeouts for Roy Oswalt tonight and up over 200. And the Wizard is working his magic tonight out there, helping Roy out. Bases empty, two away for DeFelice. Roy Oswalt has not lost since July 16th when he dropped the game to the Pittsburgh Pirates. He, along with Wade Miller, the other tremendous young starter for the Astros, have really kept Houston in the race. They went 10-0 combined in the month of August as the Astros stayed alive, going 18-11. 0-2 on DeFelice.
The biggest problem for the Astros has been their record on Fridays. 8-16. And this is a special Friday.
It's a Friday the 13th.
That bother you any at all?
A little bit. Hairs on the back of my neck are standing up right now. The 0-2 pitch. Grounded sharply, but Loretta down to get it. Bagwell with the play. 1-2-3 they go. And in that inning, he needed just 9 pitches, 21 of them in the first inning. All-star Lance Berkman's got a little Elvis look going there, but he talked with Rick Sutcliffe about his real nickname earlier tonight.
Watching you get dressed today, you were called Fatty Kruk. Things have changed.
Yeah, a friend of mine named Jacques Landry, who plays in AAA, was our third baseman at the time, and I had the long hair and it curled out the back of the helmet. And I guess I had some baby fat and sort of a, you know, maybe even more of a round face than I've got right now. And so he just started calling me Fatty Kruk, and the name stuck. And, you know, that's really what my teammates from that period of time know me as.
I mean, he's one of the most self-deprecating players that I've ever met in a game of baseball. Absolutely no ego.
Fatty Kruk, huh?
Obviously referring to John Kruk.
Tapper by Osmus, and Rowland sets him down, one away. Let's go to the studio. Reese Davis. Reese.
I'm not going to call anybody fatty. White Sox and the Yankees. This wasn't exactly a fat PH play for the Yankees. Aaron Rowan hitting it. Alfonso Soriano throwing home and a little too late. And Cena says he's got it. Oh, he tried to go Jeter on him. Tried to drop the Jeter card, but it didn't happen. White Sox get a couple. 3-2 in the fifth. And the Orioles helping out, beating up on the Red Sox 6-2. Yankees came into the night with a magic number of 8.
And it looks like it's going to start dwindling very quickly. Thanks, Reese. One away here in the second inning. Roy Oswalt hitting 111, no homers. He's driven in 4 runs. And Brian Hunter, Simontacchi also looking for a quick inning, just as Oswalt got in his top half of the second.
Here's the difference between Jason Simontacchi and Roy Oswalt. Simontacchi has to prepare his game plan for this pitch here, that 2-0 pitch. How can I get back in the count? Not so much with the opposing pitcher at home plate, but with the Bagwells and the Berkman. Most guys, like Roy Oswalt, they prepare for that 0-2 pitch. How am I going to strike him out? What's my out pitch? Jason, not really a strikeout type guy. He's just a get you out type pitcher.
The 2-1 right down the chute. Time was, and not that long ago, in fact, it was last season when Oswalt was brought up, people were calling him Oswalt. That was the pronunciation of his name at the time until it started to leak out. Well, that's not how his family pronounced it, but nobody knew that at the time. And a count 3-2 as he stays in there.
Well, listening to the Houston broadcasters, that's what they told us. And then you go 14-3 your rookie year.
Yeah,
a lot of things change.
14-3, a 274 earned run average. Just a spectacular jump on the scene by Oswalt. Here he takes ball 4. So the pitcher walks the pitcher. With one down here in the second inning. Sunday Night Baseball is coming your way, presented by Nextel, 8 p.m. Eastern Time on ESPN2. It'll be the Rangers. They're trying to play spoiler behind A-Rod, taking on the Anaheim Angels. Tied for the lead in the American League West with Oakland. Coverage begins at 7 o'clock with Baseball Tonight, presented by Pep Boys. Here are the standings. This is going to be one tremendous race. Now, what takes a little bit of the starch out of it is the fact that one of those teams is going to make the playoffs. But I'll tell you what, they're both playing like one of them is going to be eliminated. They're playing great baseball.
Well, how about what A-Rod and the Texas Rangers did to the Mariners?
Yeah, just about single-handedly knocking them out of the race. A team that won 116 games last year, and they're not going back to the playoffs. Ryan Hunter knocks it to Roland. On to second, Vina turns it, double play. 5-4-3. Cardinal fans would like to see that double play for many years to come if Scott Rolen would return to St. Louis for the multi-year contract next year, but that's still up in the air. After two, 1-0 Houston. Well, who's going to be the top dog in the RBI race in the National League? Right now it's Lance Berkman and Albert Pujols fighting it out. They're 1-2. But Pat Burrell is a close third. Sean Green's had a spectacular year for the Los Angeles Dodgers. And Jeff Kent is now up and over 100. Lance Berkman is the leader right now with 119. But Pujols has driven in 115. Pat Burrell, incidentally, with another one tonight. So 112 for the Philadelphia Phillies. Hard hit, nice stab by Vizcaino, and throws on to get Simontacchi. A fine play by Jose Vizcaino. He did it with the bat last night, and here takes a hit away from the pitcher.
He's just been outstanding, whether he played third base, second base, or here tonight at shortstop. Look at the timing. Look at, he knows he's got plenty of time. He sets himself, gets up, rotates the baseball to where he's got the four seams, knowing he's got a good grip on it, because he knows who's running. He knew that he had that in his mind before the ball was hit to him. It's the pitcher, you've got plenty of time. He just stayed calm and turned what could have been a base hit into an easy first out for his pitcher.
He's made just four errors the entire year. So he's been rock solid, and so has this man for his club, Fernando Vina. Gold glove second baseman, he doubled in the first. So he ran his hitting streak to seven consecutive games.
The biggest difference in being as a Cardinal as opposed to being with some of the other teams before, particularly the Brewers, is that after a bad at bat, I mean, he's still got the same temper. He's going to go in there and yell and tear something up, but he doesn't take it out on defense with him. What a double play he turned in the last inning. What a player he's become.
Got a lot of leadership qualities too. He's very articulate, kind of a spokesman at times for the Cardinals. And they have a lot of those kind of guys like Tino Martinez, Woody Williams, and that type. He fits in beautifully in their clubhouse. And early in the season, I remember Tony La Russa saying, you know, when Bonds was hitting all those home runs, as if he ever stopped, but I mean, first week of the season, he was unbelievable. He said, you know what, Fernando Vina is playing that kind of defense. He's doing the same thing on defense for the Cardinals that Bonds is doing with the bat. Vizcaino throws him out. Two up and two down. We'll send up J.D. Drew. He struck out in the first inning.
Well, it's the same game plan. Look at the off-speed stuff that has constantly given him trouble. Another curveball down in the dirt. You fall behind, you got to do something. Look at the extension, how quick he is on those fastballs. All right, I've seen enough of that. You go right back to the pitch that has basically put J.D. Drew in a platoon situation with Tony La Russa.
So, I mean, if you had been Roy Oswalt in the first inning, and gotten him in that spot, struck him out. Are you going back with the same sequence of pitches again?
I wouldn't here, because you got two outs and nobody on. You've got a huge ballpark going to center field and to left center field. This fastball's down and away, out over the plate.
Into left center, a diving play by Hunter. Did he hang on? He did. He caught it. Ryan Hunter laying out in left center field. His speed got him there, and the dive got him the catch. A marvelous play by Hunter. A near collision there with Ward, and he hangs onto the ball.
On the outside, it looks like a pitcher's duel, but it's because of some outstanding defense being played tonight. Ryan Hunter going a long ways to run down that pop fly, which should have been an easier play for the left fielder. But Darrell Ward, with limited range, Hunter realized that at the end and had to go get it. And I'm sure Brian would want me to say, Lucas, that one was for you. Asked me to say hello to his 8-year-old son who's in Portland, Oregon, watching Dad tonight.
Wow, and he's watching Dad with a great big grin on his face. Daddy did a great job hanging on to that ball, and you can see he's terrific in the outfield to begin with, but the ball and the glove sandwiched under his body as the weight of his body came down on it, and he still gripped it for the out. Biggio to lead off here in the third inning, 1-0 Houston. The Astros trying to take two in a row from St. Louis. Cardinals came into this series on an 8-game winning streak. Gently tapped for Rowland. That's the easiest play Scott Rowland's made tonight. One gone.
He makes a lot of them look easy. And being Rowland, just amazing range he has going along with that size. That reminds me of a guy I played a couple of years with, Cal Ripken. Mobility. He'd like to have eight Scott Rowland. They could play anywhere on the field.
Well, he's won 3 gold gloves, and you'd have to think at this point, he's made 12 errors, which is as many as he made last year. He is the odds-on favorite to win it again. Lance Berkman 1-for-1 tonight. He singled his first time up. But when you look at Scott Rowland, his size, 6'4", same size as Cal Ripken Jr.
Look at how much range Rowland's got. Look at that.
Huh? Well, that might be a little overstated.
Okay, maybe it has something to do with Berkman.
Big shift on for him. Berkman batting this time with nobody on base. There were 2 on when he singled in the first inning, but he couldn't drive anybody in.
Well, here's that pitch that's a key for Jason Simontacchi, the 2-0 pitch. How do you get back in the count?
A strike right there, 2-1. Berkman a switch hitter. Two of his home runs this year, 2 of the 40 have come off of lefties. So 38 home runs off of right-hand pitchers. He says he'd like to vastly improve that, balance it out a little bit more, a la Chipper Jones about 5 or 6 years ago.
How about this? What does that tell you? When Berkman hits a ball on the ground, he pulls it. When he hits it in the air to the opposite field, it goes a long ways.
On the outside corner for a strike. Well, Berkman certainly shared your thought. Let's take a look.
Well, just watch DeFelice. What does he do? Does he bring it back to the corner? Yeah. And he's telling you that it was outside. Watch his glove. See that?
3-2 pitch. Low for ball 4. So Berkman reaches for the second time tonight. And a man on first base against Simontacchi here in the third.
For a man that's mad, that being Jeff Bagwell. Disappointed with the call, strike 3 in his first at bat with the bases loaded and nobody out. Nothing he can do about that call now, but he can try to take out that frustration on the pitcher.
And yet Bagwell, even though he wasn't thrilled with the call by Charlie Relaford in the first inning, the bases were loaded at the time and he was called on strikes. He said nothing to Relaford.
Never does. He's never shown anybody up on a baseball field.
First pitch in there for a strike. Jeff Bagwell, the only player in Major League history to record 6 consecutive seasons of 30 homers, 100 RBIs, 100 runs, and 100 walks. 6 years in a row. You just write it onto the stat sheet at the beginning of every season.
No doubt in my mind, first ballot Hall of Fame, but I had to face it.
That could have been a lot of fun.
Not at all.
Berkman at first base. Comebacker gets by the mound. That squeaks through for a base hit. Just nudging it into the outfield. Berkman, as it's misplayed by Edmonds, heads for third. Bagwell to second. And now they're on at second and third. Jim Edmonds got sloppy out there in center field. And there are 2 men in scoring territory for the Astros.
Well, that's just a rare mistake made by another Gold Glove Award winner for the St. Louis Cardinals. You know, Edmonds last night made a mental mistake. When Scott Rowland hit a fly ball, Albert Pujols hit a fly ball down the right field line,
Edmonds was off and running on that fly ball, thinking there was two outs. There was only one. He was doubled up at first base. Pujols did not get the RBI, and what turned out to be a close game. Now a physical mistake on the part of Edmonds. It's an opportunity for the Astros once again to load the bases with this intentional walk and only one out.
Ward to be put on. And so for the second time in the first three innings, the Astros will fill the bases. And looking for a big hit from Mark Loretta to bust it open early if they can. A rare mistake by Edmonds, one of the slickest fielders in the game. That was his fifth error. There's just no reason to overrun that ball.
That's just a mental mistake. It looks physical, but that's mental. That's just not being focused and realizing what you have to do. Berkman had no thoughts of going to third base, but tell you what, Jeff Bagwell is not the fastest base runner in the game, but in a lot of people's opinion, I've heard our own Harold Reynolds say that he's the best base runner in the game. Kept his head up, didn't take it for granted it was just a single. When he saw Berkman take off, he followed that, taking the double play out of order.
Mark Loretta, the batter, is 0-for-1, having popped out in the first inning. That was with the bases jammed. He swings and flies it in a shallow right center. Edmonds to make the catch. Tagging up Berkman. He's trying to score. The throw home, a good one, but it's not in time. Throw to third, the tag, and they get him. Bagwell out at third base for out number three. So it winds up a disjointed double play, although the run comes in to score to make it 2-0. Give the RBI to Loretta on the sacrifice fly. It is 2-0, Houston. Well, the Astros have come up with the early runs, 2-0, the lead over the St. Louis Cardinals. Rick Seckler, Dave O'Brien from Minute Maid Park in Houston. Jim Edmonds trying to redeem himself a bit. He made an error in the previous half inning, but he also contributed to this double play.
Well, he makes an outstanding throw. Look at him. I mean, he knew that he was the reason this situation was in place. He overthrew the cutoff man. That led Jeff Bagwell to believe that he could get to third. But DeFelice picking up that short hop, making a perfect throw to third base, ended the inning.
Edmonds walked in the first inning. So Jim hitting 322 against right-hand pitchers, 301 overall. And 20 of his home runs, 20 of the 26 off of righties. One ball and two strikes. On deck, Pujols, and then Scott Rowland. Last pitch, 69 miles an hour, that curveball from Oswalt.
I don't know how you do that with your delivery looking exactly the same.
And you're talking about a guy, that one 89, talking about a guy who's thrown as hard as 97 tonight. He's only 6 feet tall, 175 pounds.
Well, that's why he was a 23rd round pick. They just didn't expect the type of velocity that they're seeing right now. And he came from a small high school down in Mississippi. Very few scouts had an opportunity to see him. I mean, there was only 32 people in a senior class.
Yeah, he said where he grew up in the little towns in Mississippi, they don't send scouts to come see you.
They're sending them there now.
See if they can find another Royals.
See if he's got a younger brother, or he might even take your sister. Look at that confidence. Leadoff hitter here, top of the fourth inning. Pujols on deck as a tying run, and he not worried at all about walking and throwing that curveball in the strike zone.
3-2 pitch, lined and sinking into center field. Another attempt by Hunter, but he can't come up with this one. Although he came awfully close to making his second serious catch of the night. A base hit for Edmonds.
Outfielders will tell you that that toughest ball to get a read on is the one that's hit right at you. He didn't get the same jump he got on that terrific play when he went over into left center as he needed to get to that ball. Still a nice job by Brian keeping it in front of him. Not committing an error, not letting the ball get past him, and allowing Edmonds to continue running.
So one on for Albert Pujols, who is 0-for-1. He's flied out to right field. The great story on Oswalt was the fact that it was not his baseball coach in high school, but his football coach that got him a scholarship to Tiny Holmes Junior College. He was a pretty good receiver and defensive back in high school. So he wasn't even being looked at as a baseball player. Big swing and a miss by Pujols. And the count is one ball and one strike. Roy says, when you come from the places I do, you won't get many looks. And in fact, the first time he was ever on an airplane was when the Astros signed him to a contract.
That's great.
1-1 pitch. Fouled off the line by Pujols. On deck, Scott Rolen.
Hit by Jim Edmonds. Just the second one of the night for the Cardinals here as we're in the fourth inning. Only one time in Oswalt's last 10 starts has he allowed more hits than innings pitched.
19-6 coming into tonight with a 2.84 ERA. Swing and a miss, and Pujols is down, hacking away. One gone. Let's go to the studio. Here's Reese Davis. Reese.
Guys, Reds and the Cubs. Fred McGriff. 4-4 game in the fifth, and when he launches this one, becomes the 40th player in big league history to reach 1,500 RBIs. He's third among active players behind Bonds and Palmeiro with 1,501 for his career. And with one more homer, he'll become the first guy ever to hit 30 for five different teams.
Got to believe he'll do it. Foul tip by Scott Rolen. He's 0-for-1 with a fly out to right tonight. As the Cardinals try and get on the scoreboard, Edmonds at first and one away. Scotty Rolen 2-for-4 in the first game of this series. When you look at the season that Rolen has put together, he jacks that one into left, and that one is going to get by Warden all the way up against the fence. Edmonds heading into third. They're going to wave him in. He's going to try and score, and he will. Standing up, he glides on home. An RBI double for Rolen, and St. Louis is on the scoreboard. It's 2-1 Houston. 97 RBIs for that man, Scott Rolen.
Yeah, and they're starting to come in a hurry. That's now 29 RBIs in just his last 32 ball game. He makes a nice adjustment, once again turning on that ball on the inner half of the plate. Darrell Ward is not out there because of his defense. He's out there because they expect him to drive in some runs. He's already done that tonight.
And so the Cardinals have cut the Houston lead to one in this all-important game on a Friday night in Houston, Texas. And Ausmus out to the hill. Brad Ausmus will tell you that Roy Oswalt shakes him off more than any other pitcher on the Houston staff. In fact, more than any of the rest of them combined. But it doesn't bother him at all.
Not at all. He's got no ego. He realizes that a pitcher that knows himself is going to know more about what he's comfortable with than even Brad does.
And that's exactly Oswalt's situation. Ausmus feels like he has a great game plan despite the fact he's only 25 years old. He sticks to it. And he's smart enough to make adjustments in the course of a game where pitchers his age usually can't do that. Swing and a miss by Martinez. Tino 0-for-1. He's lined out hard to left tonight.
You know, I'm just guessing right now, but Oswalt called Brad Ausmus out before this at bat. And I'm guessing that he says, what do you think here? How do I go about it? You know, I know that we were able to get him out the last time, but he hit the ball on the line to left fielder Darrell Ward. Well, they're going slower, and maybe something high and inside to finish him off with.
And Tino's 5-for-10 in his brief career meetings against Oswalt. He's getting a bat on the ball there to stay in. Nothing in two on him.
Yeah, Roy was telling me tonight that he had the Cardinals beat. He's 0-1 in his brief career. This is just the fourth start against St. Louis this year. But he said Tino beat him on a fastball in. He hit a home run to tie the ball game up and keep Roy from that first victory against the Cardinals.
The tying run at second. Tino jumps away and hit him anyway. He'll take his base. He gets struck by the pitch. The fastball in, spinning Tino around, got a piece of him there.
You know, that's a mistake that a lot of young pitchers make that you don't expect to see from Roy Oswalt. If you're going to come in with the count 0-2, you've worked too hard to get ahead in the count to just nick him and give him his base. If you miss with that pitch, miss up and over the plate, not on the inner half of the plate where it can just flat possibly touch him. Well, Tino said it hit him in the arm. That didn't come close to his arm. It looked like it might have grazed the jersey.
Umpires often go on sound in a spot like this, but Tino added the elbow there, and that's ball one inside on Renteria. Let's take one more look at it, see if we can pick it up.
I thought it got him, but on a closer look, which is a lot better opportunity for us than what Charlie Rutherford had, Tino turned around and threw his elbow to the home plate umpire.
That's the thing, is Bert Hooten is out there to talk with Oswalt, who's gotten a little bit wild here. I didn't think that Charlie Rutherford was going to give him the base until Tino showed him an elbow. He said, well, it got me, and then all of a sudden, there's the call, and down to first he goes. But I didn't think he was going to do it.
Well, they'll both watch the tape after the game.
Yeah.
And if Rutherford is proven wrong, which it looks to be, he's got two more games in this series with Tino. He won't be real happy with it.
Tino's only been hit by a pitch twice all season.
That was just a huge mistake there by Roy. I know you got the bottom part of the lineup coming up, but when you got Edgar Renteria hitting seventh, you're strong.
Ground ball, base hit through the hole. Rolling into third, he's coming around. Ward's throw to the plate is not a good one at all. Throw to third, not in time to get him. So Roland scores to tie it. Tino Martinez goes all the way down to third on that RBI base hit. And it's a single for Edgar Renteria to tie it at two.
Manager Jimmy Williams had a decision to make tonight. Do you try to go with the offense Darryl Ward can provide and suffer with the defense? Here, look at this throw. I mean, that's a horrible throw. You missed the cutoff man. You missed the pitcher, which allows Tino being heads up to get to third base. With a lot of guys, I don't think Jose Okino would have even attempted to send Scott Rowland in that situation. But he's seen the lack of defense on the part of Darryl Ward tonight, and St. Louis takes advantage of it again.
And lack of defensive ability there in left, and not that we're piling on Ward, but it certainly is hurting Houston in this inning.
Well, Darryl's a first baseman. He's trying to play another position.
DeFelice with a pop-up into short left field. Out goes Vizcaino. Ward in, and Vizcaino with the catch. Renteria goes about halfway and now scoots back into first. So they're on the corners with two out.
Well, that tells you right there what Jose Vizcaino thinks about Darryl Ward as an outfielder. He didn't want to take any chances on what a ball that was clearly Darryl Ward's was. Look at this. Look at how far he has to go. Ward's there. It's an easy play. It's a much easier throw coming in. But Jose says, uh-uh. No, I've seen enough of this. I'll take it from there. I'll
tell you what, he's making Darryl Ward look like a designated hitter. 2-2 tie, two down here in the fourth, and Simontacchi, the pitcher, will come on up. And there have been three hits and a hit batsman in the inning. So Oswalt, who breezed through the third inning on just a handful of pitches, same deal with the second inning, has had trouble in this frame. Each side with two runs, four hits, and the breaking ball is in for strike. Simontacchi swings a pretty good bat, so you got to watch it here. Sitting 233 for the season. He has 10 hits. And he gets another breaking ball. That tells you something. Back-to-back off-speed pitches. So he hasn't had the fastball yet, the big fat one. Fernando Vina on deck. Two runs in for the Cardinals. Fastball breaks the bat. Bagwell will take it himself, and the side is retired. But the Cardinals fight back, and they tie it up. And it's a 2-2 game. The Cardinals tie it 2-2 as we present the bottom half of the fourth inning. Lance Berkman, the all-star outfielder of the Astros, talked to Rick Sutcliffe about how his father got him to switch hit, a very unusual method.
He's kind of from the old school, so he never wanted me to lift weights or anything, but he did know that strength is an important part of the game, so he got an old tire and he hung it up in the backyard from a cedar tree and gave me one of his old bats, which is about a 35, 36, you know, wood bat. And so he made me swing and beat on that tire from both sides of the plate. So I think that really helped me, you know, develop some of my power, because it really teaches you how to coordinate your hips and your hands, and you have to drive through the tire, or else. I remember the first time I swung at it, I hit it and the bat bounced back and almost hit me in the forehead. So it really forces you to get down through the ball.
I cracked up the whole time.
That's great stuff.
We're probably there for 20 minutes, and he's talking about old cedar trees and tires and swings, and I could have stayed there all night. What a great young man.
Yeah, his dad, Larry, who, by the way, is his agent and helped him sign a three-year, $10.5 million contract over the winter to remain in Houston for a long time. And his dad was a huge fan of Mickey Mantle. Of course, the greatest switch hitter of them all.
Weren't we all?
Oh, yeah. And his son has actually put himself into the record book alongside Mickey Mantle as one of five switch hitters in the history of the game to hit 40 home runs in a season. Mickey Mantle did it four times. And this year, Lance Berkman has joined him.
You know, one thing Mickey Mantle never did, though, was in the same year hit 50 doubles and over 30 home runs. And Lance has already done that. Just getting started.
Swing and a miss by Vizcaino. Chipper Jones' dad was also a major league Mickey Mantle fan, and Chipper is one of the guys who has hit 40 home runs as a switch hitter in the same season. The other guy was Ken Caminiti, and Todd Hundley another. 3-2, slicing fly right at Pujols for the out. How good can Lance Berkman be? I mean, he's this good now. How good is he going to be, particularly, Rick, if he plays his whole career here in this ballpark?
Well, you know, he's continued to improve as a hitter, but he's also continued to improve defensively as an outfielder. He, like Darrell Ward, would prefer to play first base. That's his natural position, but you've got a roadblock there with Jeff Bagwell.
First pitch in there called strike on Osmus. He's 0 for 1 tonight. Oswalt up next, a 2-2 tie in the last half of the fourth inning. Simontacchi misses the corner. Talked about Lance Berkman's improvement defensively. And how about this catch early in the season? May 18th, up Towse Hill, and he made the catch. Lost the cap. And he had a priceless grin on his face as Osmus smacks it down the line. Brad Osmus runs very well for a catcher. He's into second as Pujols finally reaches it. He'll be content with a double. So the Astros looking to get that lead back. One down in the fourth and a man at second.
What a year he's having. Probably the best year of his career overall, that being Brad Osmus. The reason this ball club has gotten back into the chase has been because of their pitching. Bagwell said that's been our strength all year long. Well, the assistant pitching coach is the man we're looking at right now.
Well, an Ivy League education, a Dartmouth man, one of the smarter catchers in the game. And here's Oswalt. He walked in the second inning. One down, the Astros trying to go back in front, and Oswalt cannot contain himself there. Jason Simontacchi on the mound tonight for the Cardinals, trying to go to 11-5. We talk about two young pitchers who have surprised with the seasons that they have put together. Oswalt came up last year, of course, went 14-3 out of nowhere for the Astros. Simontacchi has turned into quite a find for the Cardinals after that long and winding road through stops with the Italian Olympic team. He also pitched professionally in Italy.
Bobby Cox, after his first start for Simontacchi against the Braves, saying, how in the world did Italy not win that gold medal with this guy? He's not a fluke.
Yeah, he beat Bobby Cox and the Atlanta Braves in his major league debut. 3-2 with seven outstanding innings.
Roy Oswalt's got a little bit of Olympic history as well. Back representing the United States in Sydney in the year 2000. A couple of starts, an ERA of 1.38.
The thing that really seemed to set him apart a year ago in this season, in his bid to win 20 games, the phenomenal command and poise he shows on the hill. Simontacchi is 4 years older than Oswalt, but has given the Cardinals a tremendous lift in a very difficult year. It's across for a strike, and it's 2-2. Ryan Hunter up next. The Astros, including tonight, with 15 games left. They have six with the Cardinals, including this one. punched down the right field line, but foul. And Oswalt is still swinging.
You know, of those six games, obviously three of them in St. Louis. Tonight, two more here in Houston. I read in yesterday's paper, and Bagwell talking to him today, they're all saying that, you know, if we just win three out of four, we'll be fine. I don't agree with that.
I think they have to sweep.
I think they have to sweep here. Last night was huge.
5.5 out at the moment, the Astros are. 3-2 the count. And boy, Simontacchi walked the pitcher in the second inning. If he misses again, he'll do it in back-to-back at bats to Oswalt.
I don't know if you blame Jason or you just give some credit to Roy. He's battling up there.
Still battling as he flicks a foul out of play. When you look at the Astros record, look at their schedule, the Cardinals have it a little bit tougher. Because as you pointed out, they have those three with Arizona. They're going to run into the big two.
That's right. There's a difference between three with the Diamondbacks with and without Randy Johnson and Curt Schilling. Right now, they're scheduled to have to face them.
The Astros have six remaining with Milwaukee. The worst record in the National League. Another one poked down the line, foul. Quite an effort by Oswalt, even if he winds up striking out here or making it out. Eight pitches so far, he has caused Simontacchi, his opponent, to throw.
You know, another chance that the Astros have, you and I looking at the schedule all afternoon today, they finished the year in San Francisco with three games. That might be the break they need if the wild card comes down to one of those two teams.
Absolutely.
I'd much rather face them.
3-2, and again a piece of it. And with each foul ball, the crowd gets more and more into it. And more involved. Here's a look at the schedule for Houston. You see their one loss record against those clubs, what really stands out, of course, 4-9 against St. Louis. Tell you what, Roy Oswalt, he may only be hitting .111 for the year, but he's making Simontacchi earn this out. And there it is for strike three. Got him looking, two gone. We've got college football coming up on Saturday at noontime. Georgia Tech and Clemson coming your way. Tech led by Tony Hollings, who's gained 298 yards in his first two games. At 7 o'clock, presented by Suzuki. College football continues with game day. And then at 7:45, it'll be number 5 Florida State against Maryland. FSU led by Chris Ricks. And has already beaten Iowa State and Virginia. All coming up on Saturday. College football on ESPN. Ricks, the junior quarterback for the Seminoles, has them out to a 2-0 start. They're averaging 39 points a game, and he's completed a lot of passes. Ryan Hunter fouls one away, runner at second base. That's Brad Ausmus. Two out here in the fourth inning.
Absolutely my favorite time of the year right now.
It is.
Oh, you've got the pennant races, you've got the home run chases, the Cy Young Award, you got Schilling and Randy Johnson going back and forth. The wild card, you've got college football, professional football kicking off. There's just so much to do and so much to watch and read in the sports page every day.
Are you Captain Remote in your household? I mean, you never let go of the thing?
Absolutely. Unless my daughter's there.
Yeah. And then you're not watching TV, I know that. You're not watching any TV. Ryan Hunter 1-for-2 with a single, and he's hit into a double play. He's also made a marvelous catch. Hunter, a fascinating guy in this respect. I mean, a few years ago, go back to 1997 when he was a Detroit Tiger. He stole 74 bases to lead the American League that year. Well, this year, the Astros, they don't run too much. He's only stolen 5 bases, but it's amazing to see that kind of a fall off and how a team's philosophy and a ballpark, especially a home run hitter's park like this, can just stop a running game for a guy like Hunter.
It has more to do with the manager.
It does. Yeah, Jimmy doesn't like to. I mean, he manages everything.
He controls every single thing that happens on a baseball field, and along with third base coach Gene Lamott, does it well.
Just wide. Two balls, two strikes. I think both sides are trying to figure out where the corners are, and they'd like a little more consistent strike zone. Both starting pitchers. Charlie Relaford has had some rather odd looks. Ball toward the hole, cut off by Roland. And he slings it on over for the out. One man left. Sut Soapbox is coming your way next. Rick talking about the effect of a veteran catcher on a young pitcher like Simontacchi.
Soapbox, we're going to talk catchers. We know that there's only one Mike Piazza, a guy who offensively from that position can carry a team offensively for a month at a time. But there are two guys here that are every bit as important to their teams as Piazza is. Mike Matheny and Brad Ausmus. They've won gold gloves in the National League the last 2 years back to back. They save the pitchers. They control the running game. They block balls in the dirt. Very important as far as the outcome of a game is concerned. But the most important thing they do is that they consistently get the starting pitcher deep into the ball game. That saves the bullpen. That takes pressure off the offense. How do they do it? Well, the first thing they do is they memorize the game plan. But most importantly, they're not a slave to it. They know that to begin with, if they're going to pitch a guy inside, they'll stay there until they see him adjust. If he moves off the plate, well, before it's too late for the starting pitcher, they'll throw the fastball away, throw something off speed, until then tell the young guy afterwards the reason that they did that. You ask Roy Oswalt, who's going for his 20th win tonight. You ask Matt Morris, who last year won 22 games, how important Matheny and Brad Ausmus are in the big picture of their ball clubs and their success.
Well, two of the very best there. And it's our opinion it'll be Brad Ausmus again to win another gold glove in the National League. He won it last year, his first gold glove.
You know, it's almost like cheating with those two guys having a coach on the field.
Who is your guy when you first came up into the big leagues? Did you have a guy like that, a catcher that you really leaned on?
Right off the bat, from the very beginning, it was Johnny Oakes. He caught me most of the time in L.A. And then in 83, I got to go to my first All-Star game. I sat in the bullpen just picking the brain of Bob Boone. On the rest of the league, how do you get this guy out? I knew he knew a lot more about it than I ever would.
Vigna with a swing and a miss. He strikes out. So Fernando Vigna, one out of three tonight. Johnny Oates, a guy who obviously became a big league manager, but a very highly respected manager and a great mind. But when you're with a guy like that earlier in your career, it's not just pitch selection and stuff, right? I mean, it's the mental part of the game that you're feeding off of.
Absolutely it is. You know, the confidence factor that's involved, how this with one little move of their arm or their body, they can make an adjustment as far as your mechanics are concerned. I think that's what's so helpful with Dave Duncan, being the terrific pitching coach that he is. All of the success that he has had, not really being handed great pitchers to begin with. Eckersley, Dave Stewart, Bob Welch, you say, well, he was blessed with those guys. Those guys were struggling when Dave Duncan got a hold of him. But I think his best project yet is the guy on the mound for the Cardinals tonight, Simontacchi, coming over and just from nowhere.
Yeah, right off the scrap heap, really. And he's a...
Couldn't have been a more difficult spot, you know. He was the guy that replaced Daryl Kyle. And that's tough enough in its own. Nobody's ever going to replace him, but somebody had to go out there every fifth day. And Jason was the guy that did it. Asking Dave Duncan before the game, you know, when he got sent back down, what's different about Simontacchi now? He says he listens better. Well, with a guy like Duncan and Woody Williams on your team, I'd be a real good listener myself.
Jim Edmonds has walked and singled and has scored one of the two Cardinal runs. This game in a 2-2 knot here in the fifth. You expect it to be nip and tuck not only tonight but tomorrow as well and all the remaining games with the Cardinals. Simontacchi, I'd have to believe getting sent out to Memphis would make a guy listen real well too when you come back to the big leagues, but that was a very short stint. Now back up and trying for his 11th win. A ball to Edmonds.
Look at who he's sitting by now. Huh? Chuck Finley. There's a few victories there. Matt Morris right in front of him. Finley was outstanding last night.
He really was.
Oh, Bagwell and Biggio talking about that split finger that he was throwing is as hard as anyone they have ever seen. I mean, it made me think back to Mike Scott here in Houston. Had a win. They were into the eighth inning with that victory. Chuck said, the National League got me. I said, that's why I stayed in that American League so long. Wasn't much of a hitter. Pinch hit for last night.
Six strikeouts in five innings. The Astros came back and won the ball game. A late three-run homer by Jose Vizcaino to take it 6-3. One ball, one strike on Edmonds. As we pointed out earlier, loves to hit in this ballpark. Really in a comfort zone here. Overall, Jim at 302. He's not having a good month of September. Coming into tonight, 7-for-34 for the month. That's a 206 average. So he needed to get back to his favorite part. Hitting over 420 here in his career. J.D. Drew at first base after his one-out single. Cut on and foul, tip to the catcher's mitt, and he got him. That's strike three. Osmus helping out the young pitcher. But Edmonds, a quick word for the home plate on Charlie Relaford. And now La Russa wants to know what happened here.
Tony's going to go out and just ask Charlie Relaford if he's sure, and if he's not sure, to ask somebody else for help. Jose Oquendo's down there saying that the ball bounced, trying to reinforce what Edmonds and Tony La Russa are trying to push across.
See if we can pick it up on a replay.
Well, we talked about Brad Osmus and how important is he is. This ball was foul tipped. All right, he gets a piece of it there. That ball did bounce.
It did. It kicked up chalk in that box.
You know, it'd be real simple just to look out to second base where your crew chief, Dana DeMuth, is, and see if he saw anything different. And you know, a lot of umpires this year have done that.
They have.
More so than any time ever in the past. And I tip my hats to them for doing that, swallowing their pride, and a lot of times getting the call right.
Yeah, the edict is get it right, and it doesn't matter which umpire gets it right. In the old days, you saw more pride come into play. The umpire who had the call would stick with it and not ask for help. In this case, Relaford didn't feel like he needed help, apparently. And so Edmund strikes out. Clearly that ball hit the dirt and he should still be up there. Second strikeout in the inning for Oswalt, trying to get Pujols now for the second time. So it's been a rough night for Jim Edmonds. He's been charged with an error. And now they ring him up when he shouldn't have been.
He came right back after that error though to get on base in the fourth inning and score the first of the two runs that tied it up.
Outside the Pujols.
That's the key. I remember Gary Matthews, the Sarge, talking about, you know, if I let one in, that means I got to drive in two.
This guy's been driving them in by twos and threes all season long. Pujols, 115 runs batted in. 2-2 on him. Now, if Albert Pujols maintains a batting average of 300 through the end of the year, he becomes the first man in history to begin his major league career with back-to-back seasons of 30 homers, 100 RBIs, 100 runs scored, and a 300 batting average.
He's just going to have to go 0 for the rest of the season not to hit 300. 313 coming into tonight's game. A lot of at-bats.
Foul tip to the net. But a pretty good cut by Albert. 2-2.
You know, you get one of these every single at bat with him. One pitch where he's right on it and he either gets it or, as this one, look at it. Oh, he can't believe he missed that ball. Contact made out in front of home plate. I mean, he might have knocked the train off the track up there in left field had he connected on that one.
He's hit 32 home runs. Drew leading at first, and that one hit toward the hole of base hit. He pulls it through for a single.
Unbelievable discipline. I mean, all of those offensive numbers that you mentioned, and only 61 times has he struck out on the year. Oswald's a power-type guy. This is going to get a lot of people, but not the left fielder for the St. Louis Cardinals. Look at that. I mean, that's just picture perfect. Getting that foot down, as Tony Gwynn talks about, seeing the ball in the inner half, rotating those hips, and hand-eye coordination that very few have.
I mean, last year with that terrific rookie campaign, he only struck out 93 times the whole season.
And that's learning the league.
And that's the first year in the National League. Well, just 61 times this year, so he's going to strike out a lot less. And he's a slugger. Here's Scott Rowland. He doubled in a run in the fourth inning. Scott is one for two.
I think we're getting to the point now. We talked in the first inning. Now, after the double, leadoff double by Vigna, Oswalt had to go as hard as he possibly could. Come the fifth, sixth, seventh inning, we were going to see what he had left. There's a lot of pitches that are thigh high and above that we normally don't see out of him. I think that first inning's taking its toll right now.
A lot of pitches, period, for Oswalt. It's 78 pitches, 21 of those in the first inning. And this one looks like it's headed to the bullpens pretty quickly for Williams and La Russa. In for a call, strike two and one on Rowland. Talking about an unusual number that kind of sticks out on Rowland. He's tripled eight times this year. 8 3 base hits for Scott Rowland. He had one triple all last year. Not looking to triple here.
Well, if he was ever going to be motivated, now's the time. Free agent at the end of the year, going to be one of the top ones out there and available if the Cardinals don't get him to sign his name.
He fouled away, and I think there are a lot of people, baseball observers, who feel that when he was traded from the Phillies, the situation he deplored to St. Louis, he'd be an automatic signee. That's not necessarily the case.
Well, and you know what? This is what's going to make him even more valuable. That used to be strike three or a pop-up on the infield or a weak ground ball. He has covered up that hole more so now than ever before in his career.
Fouled off again. Big off-speed pitch, the curveball, and he just nudged it foul.
Crowd disappointed. You hear that sigh of relief. There's nobody more disappointed than Roy Oswalt. He's tired right now. He wants to get out of this inning with the score still tied, get back to the bench, and let the Killer Bees hopefully do something in the bottom of the fifth.
He has not lost since the middle of June. Two on, two out. Swing and a miss, and he struck him out. He gets rolling in a key spot. And the ball game remains tied. So we're at the halfway point in Houston. It remains the Cardinals 2, the Astros 2, and the Killer Bees coming up to the Astros. A lot of young Astro fans on hand here tonight at Minute Maid Park. Well, it's a Friday night, big game in town. And it's 2-2, the Cardinals and the Astros. Rick Sutcliffe, Dave O'Brien with you. Thanks so much for joining us tonight. It's Friday evening in a key game. Friday the 13th, no less. Biggio has been hit by a pitch. He's also grounded out.
Well, more of a key game for the Astros than the Cardinals. With that big lead and all the confidence they have, Oswalt on the mound, the Astros have to win.
Yeah, they probably have to run the table against the Cardinals, not only in this series, but perhaps in St. Louis.
Well, they had it run on them last year when Cardinals came back from 5.5 down with just 11 games to go. Houston had to pull out a victory on the final day of the season to win the tiebreaker. And look at those right now. All that matters is that all-important loss column.
And as Rick mentioned, the Astros' last three games of the year against those Giants.
The Giants might have a makeup game that's important, though. They were held up with a rain delay, the game being halted in extra innings against the Braves. They may have to fly down there on the 30th if that game's important.
Biggio with a swing and a miss. On deck, Berkman, and then Bagwell. So the heavy hitter's up in this inning.
What do they do? They play a doubleheader that day? If that game's important and then they tie for, say, the wild card, well, they got to play somebody else on that day, too, because the playoffs are all in order to go the next day.
I got to believe they'll play it the day after the season ends. A gap shot on the run. Pujols, it gets between him and Edmonds. And Biggio's digging for second. That's a double for him. Trying to untie this ball game. A 2-2 knot here in the fifth inning. And a 14-year Astro veteran is on at second.
You know, he's already in the top 100 all time in baseball history for most runs scored. Here's another big run that Craig Biggio is hoping he can touch home plate for again. You know, Dave, you just take him for granted because he's been so good for so long. Talking to Harry Spillman, the hitting coach for the Astros tonight, about the average at 263. He said Sonny's had as many big hits. He's not had a lot of hits, but as many big hits as anybody on our team this year.
I thought his season last year was just remarkable. He hit 292 with 118 runs scored. That was right after, just a year after, massive knee surgery. He had his knee all torn up in a game down in Florida the season before. And to have such a good year so quickly shows you what a hard worker he is and how much he loves to play.
His pain tolerance, along with Bagwell, is just higher than most.
Yeah. Berkman takes it outside, one ball and one strike.
Those are the kind of employees you'd like to surround yourself with. I know the great owner of the Astros, Drayton McClain, really proud of the fact that they're not only good players, but they're better people in the community here in Houston. There he is. What a nice man.
The 1-1, nobody out, and Berkman takes it outside. Another man in scoring position for Berkman. And this is where he has cashed in time and time again, hitting 363 in these spots coming into tonight. Big star at Rice University here in Texas, just a couple of miles from Minute Maid Park. He's a great college hitter. Strike 2-2. So he's about as Texas as you get, Lance Berkman.
Well, this isn't Simontacchi on the mound. This is Pablo Picasso with that fastball. Unbelievable command. Painting the inside corner on strike one. Just nicked the outside corner for strike two. What else you got in your paint bucket?
We'll see on the 2-2. Try the inside brush, and it's all filled up now. Three balls, two strikes on deck. Jeff Bagwell. The hits are even at six. Scoreboard dead even at two. Low for ball four. So Berkman is on base for the third time tonight. You made a great point earlier this evening, just looking at the face of Lance Berkman. And he looks like he's about to nod off and take a nap inside that batter's box. He is so at ease in there.
You know, Bagwell says he's just in his own world. Nothing bothers him. There's no ups and downs. And when I hear that, I think of the parents and how much credit they deserve for raising that young man right. And he will admit it. You know, he's been blessed to come up in the same clubhouse with Bagwell and Biggio. They set the tone. They make you feel comfortable right away.
Biggio there at second base. Bagwell now in the box. He has struck out looking and singled. Up and in. We've seen that over and over the last dozen years. Bagwell leaning right over that plate. Really flying into the ball, 1-0.
He just can't get out of the way, particularly with that lead hand. Look at the pad there on top of his left hand. Jeff broke that bone in there a couple of times because he just doesn't get out of the way. He won't give.
On the inside edge for a called strike. What's amazing about Bagwell, despite the broken hand, which has happened on multiple occasions, he does not wear an elbow guard in there. He's a guy who also gets hit quite a bit. Most guys, home run hitters like Bagwell, who dive into the pitch, they're all padded up there. But not Bagwell. Going the other way, a long fly to right field. Drew backing up to the track, to the wall. He leaps, and he caught the ball. J.D. Drew came back with it. He took a home run away from Bagwell. Down to third moves Biggio. That ball was out of here. And Drew, scaling the fence and right, takes it back in. That should have been a three-run homer.
Yeah, that's the most important part of it. Bagwell could care less about the homers. That's a three-run lead that he would have handed to Roy Oswalt. Look at the timing on that play. That's the most amazing thing. That wasn't one of those towering shots that we've seen Bagwell hit. That was basically a line drive that he had to run down full blast, know where the wall is, time your jump, and then still hang on to the baseball after colliding with that wall.
That's kind of the kind of thing you're supposed to see in a pennant race. And a heck of a catch for a platoon player, J.D. Drew. And Bagwell has had a frustrating night at called third strike, and now this, a three-run homer, and he gets it taken away.
Get ready, Carl Ravage, Harold Reynolds, Peter Gammons, all the Baseball Tonight crew. We've got your Web Gym winner.
Here's Darrell Ward. Little pop up in the right, shallow. Here comes Drew, charging in. He's got it. Biggio will try and score. The throw home, the tag, the collision, and he is out at home. What an inning for J.D. Drew. He saves four runs in one inning. I don't think I've ever seen that. DeFelice absorbing the collision. As Biggio tried to bowl him over, he does. But look at this throw. And DeFelice hangs on for out number three. J.D. Drew, the only reason, Rick Sutcliffe, that this game is still tied 2-2. I don't think I have ever seen in 12 or 13 years of calling Major League Baseball an outfielder take away four runs in a single inning with his defensive play. I know you've seen it. I've never seen it. That's incredible.
If I have, I don't remember it.
Yeah.
You know, Bagwell said this afternoon when I talked to him, he said, J.D. Drew just kills us. Well, you know, you don't always have to touch home to contribute to a victory. You do something like he just did in that past inning, keeping the opponent from touching home. Well, that helps as well.
A marvelous play by Mike DeFelice, the St. Louis catcher as well. Popped up by Martinez right through the chute. And Osmus makes the catch, run away. But these two plays, starting with the catch on the Bagwell fly with two men on.
Look at the timing. Coming down with that. The heads-up play on the part of Biggio to tag and get to third to set up this. What had to be a perfect, strong throw and a strong man at home plate. Look at Biggio. Look at that. Look at him. I mean, that's a full shot. That's 90 foot to come flying at your catcher. And he still holds on to it, and it got there in time.
Renteria flares a base hit into right center field with one down. His second hit tonight. As Hunter hustles the throw in. 2-2 tie here in the sixth. J.D. Drew with a dreamlike inning for a right fielder.
You know, there's so much talent there. I mean, we've seen him scale a wall. We've seen his arm strength. We know about his power. Hit one in the upper deck, foul in his first at bat. But, you know, you just sometimes you question the motivation. You know, he just doesn't seem to always be in it. And I know that injuries are a factor there.
Yeah, he's been hurt a lot.
You know, the guy himself is the only one that knows how bad he's really hurt. But what a load of talent.
Well, the Cardinals have been frustrated at times with him because of talent on display like that and his inability for long stretches to stay in the lineup.
I hear that they're probably going to move him in the offseason, particularly if they have to free up some money with the signing of Scott Rowland. That's their main objective right now, is to get Rowland onto a long-term contract.
I'll tell you what, if they're looking for suitors, they're going to have a copy of that inning on tape to show to anyone who may want to deal for J.D. Drew, and there are going to be a lot of them, because he is gifted. DeFelice 0 for 2. He's the man who hung on and absorbed the blow from Biggio. The runner goes, swung out and missed. Here's the throw by Osmus. It's bobbled down there by Craig Biggio. So Renteria has a stolen base. Very tough to steal off of this combination of Oswalt and Osmus, but Renteria did it.
Well, Brad had to stay back. It's certainly the hit and run. You see that the hitter getting in the way, that being DeFelice just slightly, but being a catcher himself, he knows how to avoid that interference call. Just blocked Osmus enough from getting off a perfect throw to second base. And, you know, Tony La Russa not afraid to roll the dice. I mean, he even with the pitcher coming up next, putting the hit and run on.
20 stolen bases for Renteria. And now the Cardinals are threatening. A check swing, and he fouled it off. This is how hard it is to steal off of Oswalt. Dave Roberts stole one off him in his last start, and that broke a streak of 22 consecutive starts where no one stole a base off of Oswalt.
They usually don't even try. couple of reasons. I mean, his time to home plate is good, but he's real athletic as far as having quick feet and making pickoff throws. So a guy that has an extended lead.
Simontacchi, the pitcher, up next. One down. As the Cardinals, who scored twice in the fourth inning to tie it, look for their first lead tonight. And it's slap foul.
You know, two things that I saw in that play. One, obviously not the best throw from Brad Ausmus, but how about Craig Bijou? There's one out. Ball's in the dirt. Some guys might try to make a swipe tag in the perfect play to get the out. He knows if that ball gets by him, Renteria is going to be standing on third with one out. Well, what's he do? He just puts his body right in front of it, tried to make the play with the glove, but if he didn't get the ball with the glove, he knew his body was going to keep Renteria there.
Outside for ball, and you saw on the cap of Craig Biggio, the initials DK for Darryl Kyle, his former teammate, former Houston Astro and St. Louis Cardinal. Died tragically this season. Biggio and Bagwell among his closest friends in the game. Filed back to the screen, still 2-2. No, and something special coming up tomorrow.
Absolutely. This is from the Jeff Bagwell Foundation, founded this year by him and his wife Erica. And they're going to give out 5,700 of these tomorrow night. Kids that normally wouldn't be able to come to the baseball game. Take a look at that. I tell you what, really, this is nicer quality than the stuff that Jeff normally wears.
That's a wonderful gesture on the part of a very dear friend of Darryl Kyle.
Not only providing the free tickets, the t-shirts to everyone that comes through the door, transportation, lunch. You know, both he and Biggio. Craig's got the Sunshine Kids that he's involved with, he and his wife Patty, on a daily basis. Always having kids out here to the ball. Hey, you're just blessed in Houston to grow up here and watch those two play.
Outside for ball four, so DeFelice is on. And there are two aboard. Let's go to the studio. Here's Reese Davis.
All right, guys, the Yankees came into the game. Magic number of 8, down 3-2. The White Sox in the 8th. And Paul Konerk goes a pick flick. Putting one into left center. Here comes the big hurt. Ordonez would score as well on the White Sox. Build a 5-2 lead. They're now up 7-2 in the 9th.
But the Yankees cruising along, of course, in the American League East. Their magic number at 8, a 9.5 game lead over the Boston Red Sox.
Now, really, the only question in the American League is who the wild card's going to be that the Yankees play.
And it's going to come out of the West.
It's motivation enough to win that thing, isn't it? I'm not trying to put Minnesota down, but those Yankees are loaded for bear again.
Best team I've seen this year. And we've done Twins games and A's games. You saw they're opening up the roof as Simontacchi drops down a foul bunt. And this is, I always thought, very unusual during the course of the game. And they do this all the time here in Houston, open up the roof. And players will tell you, oftentimes it completely changes the whole complexion of the game. I mean, it might be windy on a given night. The humidity may affect it. Instead of that climate-controlled environment closed in, all of a sudden crazy things happen with the baseball sometimes.
Well, the players are going to have to get used to it because, you know what, this stadium was built for the fan, and the fans like it open. And it's impossible to open earlier in the day because of the heat down here in Texas. When it gets to a certain level, it comes open.
Simontacchi takes a strike, did not try to bunt that pitch, and now he's in the hole. 0-2, Bagwell charging in from first.
I would imagine Jeff will back up a little bit here, knowing that Simontacchi, as we've said before, can handle the bat. He's got 10 hits this year.
And certainly not an automatic strikeout. In fact, twice tonight he has put the ball in play. He's bunting again. A breaking ball, and it's bunted foul for strike three. And so that's out number 2. So he didn't get a cookie to try and drop down. He got a big bender.
You know, and I was wrong, Dave. Bagwell all over him once again, and that put pressure on Simontacchi to know he not only had to get the bunt down, but he only had one direction to put it. Look at where Bagwell's at. If you punch it back towards him, he's going to get that force play at third because of that effort. You got to be perfect. You got to get it to third base. Even though we know Bagwell with that shoulder injury can't throw very well, And that wouldn't be that long of a throw. He would have tried to make that one.
Torn labrum. He's played with it all year after the surgery. And his Vini with a swing and a miss.
He played with it all year last year. I was with him right after he started his rehab. I mean, they put screws in that thing. That was painful just to watch him do some of the things he had to rehab it back to where it's at.
Now, frankly, it was very hard to watch him throw in April and in May, trying to make plays and start a double play, for example, like a 3-6-3. It was tough.
He's talking about how the infielders laugh at him between innings when he's trying to get the ground balls to him to get him. He says half the time he can barely get it there. Well, Oswalt better get it there now because Vina's got RBI in his mind.
Ground ball softly, but Biggio gets down to scoop it, side retired. And the St. Louis Cardinals tonight are 1-for-9 with runners in scoring position. That's why it's still tied at 2. Bottom of the 6th inning, Cardinals 2 and the Astros 2. J.D. Drew's had a heck of a night out there in right field for the St. Louis Cardinals. Go back to the 3rd inning, and this is when the Astros tied up the ball game. Edmonds gunning home, but this play at third base erases Bagwell. Now watch Drew in the 5th inning stealing a 3-run homer from Jeff Bagwell and then making a catch, and with Biggio tagging at third, gunning him out at the plate. The collision, DeFelice hung on for the out. That's what you call spectacular defense.
You know, the headlines for this story would have already been written if it weren't for J.D. Drew.
And Bagwell would have 3 RBIs. That one poked right at the feet. Tino Martinez. One up and one down as Loretta grounds out.
But now, I mean, that's just going to be a note halfway down in the column. We still don't have our headline yet. Where's it going to come from?
Well, a crucial game certainly for the Houston Astros. Just 5.5 games out behind St. Louis in the Central after last night's win over the Cardinals. So Jimmy Williams Club is still alive and kicking. But they have to win tonight. And they have to win again tomorrow. And they have to keep on winning. There's no margin for error. Vizcaino was the hero last night. He grounded out. He flied out his first 2 at bats this evening. But last night it was his 3-run homer in the 8th inning. It's part of a 4 RBI game for Vizcaino. He's not obviously a big home run hitter, not a big RBI man, but he buried St. Louis in game 1. Fouled off, it's 2-1.
Tell you what, he can hit the fastball. He took Mark Pryor and his fastball deep earlier this year in that same location. Down and in, just dropping the head on the bat on the baseball. Not knocking it out of sight, but just far enough.
Last night, just far enough, 6-3 Houston. And snapped an 8-game Cardinal winning streak. Now the Astros have won 14 out of their last 17. So these are 2 teams playing really well coming into this series and into this game. We pop up down the line. Pujols charging. He'll have time to get there. And they're a 2 away. Let's go to the studio for an update. Here's Reese Davis.
All right, guys, Dodgers started the 9th tied with the Giants for the wild card lead in the National League, taking on Colorado. And Brian Jordan, hero a couple of nights ago against the Giants, logs on. Jordan going yard, 2-run shot, his 16th of the year, and the Dodgers getting more offense from Eric Karros. Swatting one the other way in that thin mountain air, and the Dodgers have jumped all over the Rockies. They're on top 4-1 in the 4th.
Hey, speaking of jumping, they needed J.D. Drew in that outfield. But he's here in Houston tonight. And as we check out the National League wild card picture, the Dodgers and the Giants in a dead heat. The Astros are in that race, too. Just 4.5 back.
Yeah, that looked like a pop-up off the bat of Eric Karros after what we saw Bagwell do.
Yeah. And how many times have you seen those pop-ups? You're sitting there in the press box at Coors Field, and they just keep carrying and carrying and carrying. And all of a sudden, they're 9 rows into the stands. And you're going, what in the world?
You know, I asked Mike Piazza one time. I said, you know, you played at Dodger Stadium, now Shea Stadium. You never played in a hitter's park. What? I mean, how much fun would it be for you to play at Coors Field one year? He said it'd be miserable. I couldn't keep my focus for games that last that long and all of the things that happen there. He wouldn't want anything to do with these things.
All those high scoring games, you know, all those 12-9 games, 14-7 games.
And knowing that he's grinding it out behind home plate, involved in every pitch.
Simontacchi with the bases empty, two out, but he has worked a long night already, 105 pitches.
They needed that because they got into that bullpen early last night.
Osmus last time up ripped a double. He's gone one for two.
This I tell you what, it's just Simontacchi amazing. And how comfortable he looks, confidence that you just feel. You know, we're a long ways away from him. I'm sure his teammates feel that. This guy was released three different times. I mean, in spring training, the players thought he was Japanese. They were afraid to talk to him.
With a name like Simontacchi. Renteria on the first for the third out, and it's a 1-2-3 frame for the right-hander who pitched for the Italian Olympic team at one time. We're tied at two. Well, Friday Night Baseball on ESPN, and here's what's coming next. Sports Center, as soon as we're done here.
Doing a little directing there, partner. Did you notice that?
Start directing from the booth, and those kids prove that they can take direction.
They've been great. I mean, every half inning they've been yelling, please, please put us on Sports Center. We want to be on Friday Night Baseball.
That's us over here, and here are Sutz kids.
There they are. It looked like they bet on whether they're going to be on or not. Wasn't that one kid getting his wallet out?
Yeah.
They're calling their buddies. All right, we're getting the thumbs up. That is what baseball is all about. Kids.
Tell you what else baseball is all about. J.D. Drew's tremendous play in right field tonight. He has robbed Bagwell of a three-run homer, and he's gunned down another Astro, Craig Biggio, at home plate. That was in the same inning on back-to-back plays. Just incredible. At the plate, he's gone one for three, and this is a guy who has already beaten the Astros twice this year with hits, game-winning hits, on May 22nd and 23rd. So in back-to-back games, and that last one on the 23rd of May was on a walk-off home run that he clubbed 438 feet. So the Astros have seen quite enough of J.D. Drew this year. A high chop foul, two balls, two strikes.
This is probably going to be the end of the night for Roy Oswalt. And what a huge lift statistically that is for the Cardinals. We mentioned that Roy's 19-6 on the season. But in the 30 games that he started, the team is 20-10, 1-4 with him out of the game.
He's gone to 3-2 on Drew, and he's also, as you saw, over 100 pitches. So both starters have passed that mark. Drew, Edmonds, and Pujols to battle Oswalt in this inning. And that's ball four. So he's walked three and hit a batter in this game. Normally his command is exceptional. Oswalt and Wade Miller. This is just beyond description since July 1st.
You know, and you talk about the big two, all right? Schilling and Randy Johnson. In that same period, they're 19-5. Millwood and Maddox, 18-4. Pedro and Wakefield, 17-4.
Ground ball and a base hit, smacked through the right side by Edmonds. Drew moves up to second base. And the Cardinals may be getting a wary Roy Oswalt in this inning. A walk and a single in front of Albert Pujols. That's dangerous territory for the young righty.
He struggled every inning since the fourth. And I think every bit of that is directly related to what happened in the first inning. All of the pitches that he had to throw just because of Fernando Vina. And Jimmy Williams doesn't come out very often without something on his mind. We'll see if that right arm goes up.
Yeah, usually what he comes out with is the hook. You saw Tom Gordon getting loose in the bullpen.
I think he's just asking right now, be honest with me. Tell me the truth. Look at him. He's not so much listening to what Roy has to say. He's looking into his eyes. It's kind of like the window to their soul and their heart and what's really going on. I think he's convinced Jimmy that he's okay. Why wouldn't you? I mean, he's won 9 straight decisions. He deserves the opportunity. If he's going to lose this ball game, let him touch home plate on a pitch that he's thrown, not somebody else.
Well, there have been 10 base runners in the last 3 innings against Oswalt. His average is 101. He's up to 109 now. He has not thrown more than 119 this year. But he has to face Albert Pujols with 2 on and nobody out.
Yeah, at this point in the season, he's not going to hurt himself physically. His arm's in shape. But he might get hurt with a mistake thrown to Albert Pujols.
Pujols with a single in the 5th, has hit in 8 straight games. Swings at the first pitch and pops it up. Maybe a play for Loretta near the St. Louis dugout. Leans in and it's dropped. Oh, they had an out there. Osmus and Loretta both over there. But it trickles harmlessly into the Cardinal dugout. That's a huge out, too, they should have had or could have had.
Well, you see him leaning over the fence here. I know it's not the wall in right field as a 3-run homer, but maybe every bit is big, keeping Albert Pujols from 1 swing in the bat, hitting a 3-run homer for the Cardinal. It was in the glove of Brad Osmus. Would have been an easier play for Loretta just because of the different glove that he has. Catcher's mitt not really designed to catch pop-ups.
That one may come back to haunt them inside, and it's 1-1. Talking about a tremendous RBI guy up there. And Loretta and Osmus unable to come up with it. So Pujols is still swinging. With his 115 RBIs at the plate. The infield for Houston at double play depth. It's Drew and Edmonds aboard. It's a good speed out there for St. Louis. We're tied at 2 in the 7th. Ground ball should be a double play. Vizcaino, DiVigio on the first. Got him. Close play. Pujols thought he beat the rat. Drew is safely into third base, but with 2 down. It's the 18th time that Albert has been doubled up, but he didn't think so. Neither did Tony La Russa. He's going to argue the point with Marvin Hudson.
I didn't think so either. But Jeff Bagwell sure did a great job selling the fact that it was a double play. Biggio almost gets wiped out as he did a couple of years ago when he had that knee surgery. Look at Bagwell come up with that throw, stay on the bag just long enough. He was out.
You know, on that angle, he did look like he was out.
What an outstanding call by Marvin Hudson. Just his 3rd year at the big league level. La Russa not happy with that, but when he sees the replay that we just saw, he will agree with it.
With a naked eye, I thought he was safe. On the replay, looked like he was out.
And I thought Bagwell came off the bag, but he just extended with his arm and his glove going to get the throw while keeping that right foot where it needed to be. Biggio made that play, though.
Yeah, he hung in there beautifully. Cardinals getting into another double play. And they've also turned 3 double plays tonight. St. Louis has Scott Rowland 1-for-3 with a double. He takes strike 1. Runner at 3rd. The go-ahead run there for St. Louis.
As much as we've talked about the infield defense of St. Louis, the number 1 overall defense in the National League, this is the one that's in the field right now, Houston.
Like St. Louis, 1 out of 10 with men in scoring position.
Even though he's better at handling that fastball in, they're still pounding it there. How about that? The 113th pitch of the night, 114th pitch, both 94 miles an hour. That's a big number.
The crowd into it, the loudest they've been this evening. 1-2. He tried to get Rowland to bid after the curve. Floating up there at around 71 miles an hour.
How about Osmus? I mean, I know people think I'm crazy doing a soapbox on Osmus and Matheny, comparing them along with the value of Mike Piazza, but he just kept a run from scoring.
Rowland trying to pick up that run. High fly along the right field line. Berkman's headed into the corner, going after it toward the stands. He can't get it. And he's a little bit shaken up on that play. Lance Berkman. He just dropped that glove, and now he's bending over. Trying to reach into the stands. He's waving off the trainer. He says he's fine.
I thought it was his elbow to begin with, but let's watch his right knee. Look at him go up right there, and then as he comes down, I think he just kind of hyperextended that knee a little bit. Well, what a terrific effort. And let's not forget about the pop-up earlier by Albert Pujols that was missed by even less than that one, keeping this inning still alive.
It's moments like we've seen tonight, including the great play by Drew in right field, two great plays, that define pennant races. The pitch to Rowland. He doesn't go after it again. 2-2. So Oswalt is trying to entice Scott Rowland to swing at a pitch outside the strike zone.
I think the night's definitely going to end for Roy Oswalt with the next out or the next hit that happens. But what also might end with that is the Houston Astros season.
The 2-2. Check swing on the bouncer up there at a full count. Oswalt has put 12 men on base tonight, but only two of them have scored. Another block here by the Gold Glove candidate.
Well, watch his mask. Watch the head. Look at the head. If it's not tilted down, where does that ball go? Everything. Look at the upper part of his body. Look at the tilt. That's what keeps the ball in front of you. Not all catchers do it that way. That was perfect.
If it goes to the backstop, St. Louis has the lead. And hard but foul. Rowland still working away against Oswalt here. Heck of a battle in front of 33,672. Simontacchi looking on.
Oswalt may or may not win this ball game, but he certainly won even more respect out of us than he had when this started.
A very gutsy performance. This is his 120th pitch, and it's fly to dead away center, but catchable. Hunter there, and the Cardinals strand another man in scoring position. He keeps Drew planted at third base, and we're still tied. The Cardinals 2, the Astros 2. Bottom of the seventh inning here, 2-2 tie, St. Louis and Houston. That man is finished for this evening, as Rick Sutcliffe predicted. Roy Oswalt going 7 innings. He throws a season-high 120 pitches. And with 7 strikeouts, he walks 3 in the ballgame.
Well, it's up to his buddies now as to whether he wins his 10th straight consecutive start and 20th victory overall. He has more than done his part. The Cardinals threw everything they possibly had at him, yet he answered every one of those calls. One inning were they able to score upon him.
Orlando Merced, the veteran pinch hitter, steps in there at 294. 6 homers, he's driven in 30. And it's Brian Hunter and Craig Biggio, the top of the order. The Astros had a 2-0 lead going to the fourth inning, but the Cardinals tied it with a pair of runs, and it's been frozen on the scoreboard at 2-2 since then.
I think it probably have been Merced starting in the outfield tonight had that left hamstring of his not been injured.
Octavio Dotel loosening up, so Tom Gordon has sat down in the Astro pen.
Because of the injuries and lack of production by Hidalgo, Merced's not pinch hit as many times as he has in the past. He was as good as it got in that category last year in the National League. 17 pinch hit RBIs. A grand slam he hit towards the end of the year against the Cubs. Pinch hit.
Really good bat on ball hitter. Makes contact. He's behind here. 1-2 to Simontacchi. And that's just outside. In his career, he's made a fine living as a pinch hitter. 291 lifetime. With some power.
11 pinch hits this year, but only one RBI thus far.
Drift foul out of play. Five more left between these two ball clubs after tonight. The Astros coming into this series basically to a man thinking they had to win three out of four. Line drive caught as Roland, who had shifted way off the line, makes the play. Let's go to Reese Davis in the studio. Time for an update, Reese.
All right, you guys keeping an eye on the National League Central and the American League West. A's and Angels starting the night tied. A's taking on the Mariners. David Justice strokes one up the middle. But the A's on top by a count of 1-0 in the bottom of the second. Meanwhile, Rangers and the Angels. Rafael Palmeiro, he takes batting practice. Goes the other way with it. Knocks in A-Rod, and Rangers trying to spoil things. They're up 1-0.
Line drive base hit by Brian Hunter here with one down in the seventh inning off of Simontacchi. And so the speedy Hunter is aboard. Now Jimmy Williams has a decision to make. And so too may Tony La Russa.
Yeah, Tony had a left-hander, Jeff Fusaro, up and throwing. Fusaro came on last night to get a couple of outs. But the biggest thing Fusaro would do would definitely keep Hunter from stealing second base. The left-hander in there with a good look at him, you might keep him in place. It would be a lot easier to hit and run for manager Jimmy Williams with a right-hander on the mound. Biggio can handle the bat. We'll see what unfolds.
The Astros hardly ever try to steal a base, but Hunter, especially early in his career, was a premier base stealer. He's stolen five this season. Not running on the first pitch. And Vina comes in, bottles it, tries to tag him out. Ball still alive, and the throw glances off Renteria, and everybody stays safe. First and second with one out. And Vina had all sorts of trouble with it as Hunter tried to dance around him. But that was in the base path. And so Hunter, doing everything he could to get around that little ground ball, winds up at second.
Well, both Tino and Vina are going to complain that it was runner interference, but it's not once that ball becomes live. Look at Hunter hustling in there. Vina at the last second trying to make the throw to Renteria. Look at that's a great job by Hunter stopping to keep Vina from tagging him and getting the easy double play. That's outstanding hustle right there. Look at him putting on the brakes, trying to get out of the way. All right, that's a collision, no big deal. Vina tries to get him back there at the base. Hunter hustling in there. That could be a huge play. We've talked about how close these two teams are. Well, an error one direction or the other looks like it might be the difference.
An error on Vina. You remember years ago that forearm shiver
Albert
laid on
Bell.
Him by Albert Bell?
Was it Albert? Was it Joey Bell then? I'm not sure.
I don't remember.
Doesn't matter.
Going by Albert Bell, but I know that Vina remembers it all too well. Now the shift on again off to the right side on Berkman. Top RBI man in the National League with a chance to grab number 120 here. He has singled and he's walked twice.
A little bit surprised that with Fusaro up and throwing, he's not into the ball game right now. Numbers much, much, much better for Berkman, swinging from the left side as opposed to right-handed.
1-0 pitch outside.
It's his fourth look at Jason Simontacchi tonight, and he's gotten on base all three times.
Hunter and Biggio get their leads. Fusaro looking on despite 118 pitches tossed so far by Simontacchi. Inside for ball three. Well, now you got a right-hand hitter up next.
Who hit the ball out of the park in his last at bat.
That's Jeff Bagwell.
Didn't have anything to show for it because of the great play by J.D. Drew.
3-0. Berkman swing it away and grounds it behind the bag. A high hop. Martinez hauls it in. And the runners move up to second and third. That's out number two.
What a huge pitch that was. I would imagine Tony La Russa going to walk Jeff Bagwell. You go to the bullpen, you bring the left-hander in to get the left-handed, possibly hitting Darrell Ward coming up after Bagwell. I don't let Bagwell beat me.
So they'll put him on to load up the bases.
Tony's just looking right now at what Jimmy Williams would counter with as far as a right-handed hitter is concerned coming off Jimmy Williams' bench. Hidalgo is there.
Right now, it's still Ward in the forefront, swinging a weighted bat. So Jimmy Williams has not tipped his hand yet. Bagwell to be put on intentionally.
I don't look for Richard Hidalgo to come up and hit. I look for Jason Lane. Lane had a big night last night. He was the J.D. Drew of Thursday night. The two outfield assists, he threw out Scott Rowland and Jim Edmonds. Also went 2 for 3. One of those hits was a triple. And just flat owns left-handed pitching.
So here comes Tony La Russa. Ward had started toward the batter's circle. And now Jimmy Williams waits for Becerro to be announced. Simontacchi coming out of the ball game. We're tied at 2, but the bases are loaded, and we'll be back.
ESPN's Major League Baseball, brought to you by Earthlink dial-up and high-speed internet service. Call 1-800-EARTHLINK.
Minute Maid Park in Houston, Texas, and a big, big showdown between the Astros and the Cardinals. In his fight for the National League Central flag, Tony La Russa bringing on the left-hander, Jeff Becerro here.
I might have done that just a little bit different. I might have brought in Becerro to intentionally walk Jeff Bagwell, forcing the hand of Jimmy Williams. If he were to pinch hit with a right-hander for Darrell Ward, then Tony La Russa could have gone to the bullpen and brought a right-hander in to possibly face Jason Lane. You have to obviously face a hitter when a pitcher is brought into the game. But Jimmy Williams is going to stick with Darrell Ward. Career, he's 3 for 4 off Jeff Becerro. Pinch hit last night with no success. But that was last night.
Ward in tonight's game is 1 for 2 with an RBI single. And the bases are all jammed up for him. There's a key error in the inning. Charged to the Gold Glover Vigneault. We'll see if it hurts him. 2-2 tied, 2 out. Pitch fouled off his foot for strike one. Becerro acquired from the Cubs on August 25th. He was 5-6 with an ERA over 6 with the Cubs, so he had his trouble. Well, the Astros have had the bases loaded time and time again, 3 different times tonight. With a very good power, he's hit 9 home runs. But that's misleading. You can knock the ball a mile. Swing and a miss, and it's 0-2. So Becerro comes out of the pen, facing a lefty, and quickly jumps in front of Darrell Ward. 0-2.
So many times in a close ball game, one manager or another has something to do with the outcome. Which reliever do you bring in? Who do you pinch hit with? Or do you pinch hit?
A run here as DeFelice asks for time. It goes to the hill. A run here by the Astros puts them in front 3-2. And if they hold on to that lead, tonight's starter, Roy Oswalt, could still win it. 33,672. Watching tonight inside Minute Maid Park.
Possibly watching Roy Oswalt's 20th victory with Brian Hunter just 90 feet away.
2-strike pitch sails away. And if that happens, it would be despite the very best efforts of one J.D. Drew, who in one spectacular inning saved 4 runs with a leaping catch over the right field fence, stealing a three-run homer from Bagwell, and then throwing out Craig Biggio at home plate just moments later with a dart. And despite the collision, DeFelice hung on for the out. Here's the 1-2. Ground ball hit hard, but Vigna down to get it. A fine play on a shoe touch to grab it. And Simontacchi, a happy guy, a sigh of relief. It remains the Cardinals 2 and the Astros 2. Houston couldn't score despite loading the bases. Just what you would expect between the Cardinals and the Astros. 2-2 getting late. Top half of the eighth coming away. Rick Sutcliffe, Dave O'Brien. And Rick, there are 30 major league clubs. Another 29 of them would love to have Octavio Dotel.
Yeah, and probably 25 of them would have him pitching the ninth inning as a closer, as opposed to just closing out the eighth inning as he does for the Astros.
91 innings out of a relief pitcher, and if you think that's high, you're right. In fact, it leads the majors among relievers, and 112 strikeouts. He has a live arm, to put it mildly, and facing him first, Tino Martinez.
Astros were telling me that on the recent West Coast trip, Dotel was mad. The velocity on their radar gun had him at 93, 94. He said he knew he was throwing harder than that. He put on a show last night pitching the eighth inning, 98, 99 consistently.
Tino Martinez 0 for 2. He's been hit by a pitch. And the first three have missed the strike zone from Dotel. Sports Center coming your way next as soon as we finish up here in Houston. But it may be a while before we get to Sports Center the way these two clubs are going at it. Two runs, eight hits for St. Louis. Two runs, seven hits for the Astros.
No different than the game last night. And you know what? It might even get better. Matt Morris and Wade Miller on Sunday.
Ball four to Tino. So Dotel walks the leadoff man in the eighth. Fans, this copyrighted telecast is presented by authority of the Office of the Commissioner of Baseball and may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form. And the accounts and descriptions of this game may not be disseminated without express written consent. Right now, the end draws near and the quest to win the World Series ring is on. Log on to MLB.com for your official viewer's guide so you can stay on top of all the postseason excitement. It is right around the corner. Edgar Renteria, a good bunter, 2 for 3 with a pair of singles tonight. And he drops that one down, and that'll do the job. Dotel gets it on to first. Martinez down to second on the sacrifice. The Cardinals again have a man in scoring position. Now, this is where it's gotten tough for St. Louis. They haven't done anything after this point since the fourth inning.
I think the main reason Tony La Russa went to the sacrifice bunt there was because he knows Dotel is only going to be out there for one inning. Jimmy Williams didn't make a double switch. The pitcher spot due up fourth in the bottom of the eighth for the Astros. He wanted to get Fernando Vigna in at bat against Dotel. Vigna, one of the few guys in all of baseball with numbers against Octavio. He's 4 for 9 coming into tonight's ballgame.
Well, a decision here for La Russa, with Mike DeFelice, a 234 hitter coming into the game, about to be pinch hit for. It's Kerry Robinson who will bat for DeFelice. And so the Cardinals will also need a new catcher. But St. Louis has wasted many opportunities tonight. With runners in scoring position, they're 1 for 12. The reason it's still tied, Houston's 2 for 11 with runners in scoring position. So La Russa goes to his bench. In the first two games of the series, and I know La Russa's fed up with it, the Cardinals have stranded 22 men on base. Robinson looking for a pick-me-up, and he takes ball one.
That's the first breaking ball Dotel has thrown in two nights. He didn't throw one last night.
Martinez at second, one away. That's the go-ahead run out there for the Cardinals. Robinson was late on that one. A 96 miles an hour with life.
There's a lot of people that's going to be late on that thing. Look at it climbing. His fastball reminds me a little bit of a guy from the left side a few years ago, Sid Fernandez.
Popped up. That might fall. Here goes Vizcaino. No, he makes a catch. Goes back into second. Martinez save. Jose Vizcaino got a great read on that pop-up. That might have been trouble for a lesser shortstop, but he made a fine play, and they're two out.
Well, over the course of the year, if you're not sound fundamentally defensively, those numbers will show up. Not only Vizcaino getting to that ball, Biggio on the bag for the throw, Bagwell, Berkman backing it up in case it got away.
Robinson unable to pick up the RBI in a pinch hit capacity. Now another pinch hitter. This is Miguel Cairo.
A little different story here. This is a pretty good one. One for one in his career against Octavio Dotel. Already 17 pinch hits by Miguel.
And Cairo has been swinging a very good bat over the last 3 weeks. He's hitting .343 in his last 19 games.
And you got to figure he's going to get something to hit here, because we mentioned Tony La Russa wants Vina up against Dotel. He didn't want to have Vina, J.D. Drew, and Edmonds face Wagner, possibly in the top of the ninth inning, the hard-throwing left-hander.
And at second, two out. And a late cut by Cairo. One ball and one strike. Dotel going right after Tony La Russa's pinch hitter.
You know, you can manage the best game in the world, but this game always has been and always will be about players.
You got it. All back. I will again a little tardy. One ball, two strikes.
You got good players, you're going to be a good manager. Both of these teams have them.
And you know what? Tony La Russa and Jimmy Williams would tell you exactly the same thing. The go-ahead run at second, but Dotel thinking strikeout here. 2-2.
I knew that one was going to be a big number.
98. Yeah, that's a big number.
Crowd starting to pump up the setup man for the Houston Astros.
Tino leads, two out, and here comes the 2-2. Again, a piece of it for Cairo. Cairo has been up to bat 159 times. He has struck out on 30 occasions. He's a difficult man to walk, though. He's only walked 11 times. He is up there to swing the bat.
I think that 30 strikeout total is rather low when you consider the guys that he faces a lot of time. He doesn't get many starts. His pinch hitting appearances are against guys like this.
He struck him out. A foul tip into Osmus's mitt, and that's the inning. So once again, the Cardinals get a runner into scoring position. They just can't get the hit to bring him in. Gas here at 98 by Octavio Dotel. Still tied. Last night here in Houston, it was the eighth inning that turned things around for the Astros. This home run by Craig Biggio, which started the frame, tied the game at three, and three batters later, Vizcaino hit the crushing blow, a three-run shot. That was the margin of victory for the Astros as they took the all-important game one by a final score of 6-3. As we go to the home half of the eighth here, a brand-new battery for the Cardinals. Mike Matheny is the new catcher, and Rick White is the right-hander to come out of the pen for La Russa.
White pitched an inning in a third last night. Veteran type guy, great command of the fastball, will come in when locating it, but his out pitch and best pitch is a good hard slider.
A 2-2 tie. That's been the case since the fourth inning.
You know, we saw the comeback the Astros put on last night. It's just been a series of comebacks for them this whole year. Back on June the 30th, 7 games under 500 was Jimmy Williams's team.
Well, a win tonight, if they can pull it off, will bring them to within 4.5 of the first place St. Louis Cardinals. And I think at that point, the Cardinals would have to get a little bit nervous.
Cardinals had won 9 out of 12 in their head-to-head meetings coming into this ball game, but that was back in April and May. This ballpark's been renamed since then.
A couple times, hasn't it? Working on its third name right now, although this is gonna hold up for a while, Minute Maid Park.
To me, it doesn't matter what you call it. What a beautiful facility. And Houston downtown, they've got it going on now.
It's a great spot. It's a wonderful place to broadcast the game from. A strike call on Loretta, the count 1-2. Mark tonight has gone 1-for-2. As you see, they opened up the roof around the sixth inning. Someone hit a button, and about 45 seconds later, we could see the sky. Six, seven, and eight hitting in this inning against White. That one sock foul by Loretta. Loretta acquired from the Milwaukee Brewers on August 31st. Had they waited a couple of days to make that trade, Mark would not be eligible for the postseason roster. But they got him the day before September 1st, and so he could play in the playoffs. Should they get there? Just outside third, a foul strike, still 1-2.
That's that good fastball in we talked about from Rick White, 93 miles an hour. A lot of guys that have that kind of command when they have been sitting around for 3 hours since the game started. White's always had that ability, and then a lot of times he'll follow it up with that slider.
Swing and a miss, and he struck him out with that pitch. The bat all the way to the hill. But Loretta fans, one gone. Sports Center coming up as soon as we finish up here. John Anderson and Kevin Frazier coming your way. They'll talk about the wild, wild west. It's been a wacky Friday the 13th. It always is. And the Cowboys are still in shock. Well, thanks to the Houston Texans. And Sports Center coming up right after the game. Jose Vizcaino hit the 3-run homer in the eighth inning last night. Well, he comes up with the bases empty and one away in this eighth inning 24 hours later. This guy, you know, after the home run was talking about how comfortable he is in game-winning or clutch situations. And he says it's directly a result of his time with the New York Yankees. And there's a shot off of Martinez glove. He's trying to make a play. Can't. And Vizcaino is safe at first base on the single.
I remember that single he had in game one, the 2000 World Series against the New York Mets in the 12th inning to win that ball game for the Yankees. Well, he's trying to get it started here tonight for a victory.
And Tino Martinez with a wonderful effort here just slowed it up. And they make sure to duck out of the way just in case Vina has a shot. But Vizcaino beat it over there without a throw. So here comes Brad Ausmus. He's gone 1-for-3 tonight. He's actually hit the St. Louis pitching staff very well all year. 324.
I got to look for the hit and run here. Ausmus, one of the league leaders in grounding into a double play. Take that away from him.
26 times he's hit into a double play. Only Todd Zeal has hit into more. One more.
Maguire and Biggio every night joke with Brad too that, you know, come on now. You can lead the league in that category. We're counting on you.
You can hear them both all over him about that. Almost grazed him. He takes it in tight for ball one. It is their clubhouse, make no mistake. Biggio and Bagwell, it belongs to them. I mean, if any two guys are responsible for the building of this ballpark, it's those two. Viscaino at first, one out. He's running. Swing and a miss. They did have a play on, and now Viscaino trying to get back. He's tagged out by Vigna. He got hung out. Out number two. Well, Sutton, you guessed right.
Well, again, and I'm not saying it's a bad decision by Jimmy Williams. It sure looks that way. But if Osmus would have been able to make contact, that whole right side of the infield was wide open. You play Pepper with the right fielder, you've got first and third and one out. You miss the ball. Jimmy Williams will have some questions to answer after this game.
So caught stealing on a bounder right at Renteria. That's the frame.
And that would have been the 27th ground ball into a double play.
Yeah, it would have been. Instead, just a routine 6-3. And we are headed to the ninth in Houston. Still no resolution. We're tied at two. St. Louis 2 and the Astros 2 as we go to inning number 9 in Houston. One of the hardest throwers in the game, Billy Wagner, the little left-hander. A 270 ERA. He has saved 32 games. He's coming into a situation where the game is tied and trying to get the Astros a chance to win it in the bottom of the ninth.
Billy the Kid.
Here's Fernando Vigna, first man to face him. Vigna in the contest has doubled. He's grounded a second twice. He's also struck out. So make him 1-for-4.
You know, when I think of Billy the Kid, I think of what a great farm system the Astros have and have had. He was drafted by them in the first round. Berkman, Oswalt, who we saw earlier tonight, all homegrown products here. Houston, and it keeps getting better for them.
There's another one out of their own backyard. Lance Berkman fly gently to left, backing up Darryl Ward, and on the warning track, he has one down.
Take a look at Billy Wagner. He's changed a little bit since that arm surgery he had a couple of years ago. That hadn't changed any, but this has. Look at the sharp breaking slider. He'll still blow you away. He comes back with another slider, but before that surgery, I don't think you ever, with anybody, saw back-to-back breaking balls out of him. He simply just didn't need to do that. He just could throw it by you. Now he pitches a little bit when he has to.
J.D. Drew, the batter. The bat shatters on the ground ball to the middle. Vigna throws him out. And the biggest part of that bat went all the way into right field. There it is on a short right field grass. Another bat just exploding on the diamond, and they're two gone.
Tell you where all those prospects come from, too. You look at Jason Lane. There's one of them. A double-A team in Round Rock. This is the third straight year they've either had the pitcher or the player of the year in that league. Back a year ago, it was Jason Lane and Tim Redding that captured both of those honors. This year, Kirk Sarlos, pitcher of the year down there, 13 starts, 10-1. Sorry about it. And they just keep coming.
Edmonds has reached base three times tonight with a couple of singles and a walk. And he takes ball one outside from Wagner. 33,672 on hand tonight. And we don't have a winner yet. Each side with two runs, each side with eight hits. Bagwell had a three-run homer, but J.D. Drew took that away.
You know, games like this, I don't want them to end. I mean, you just keep wondering what's going to happen next. It's going to be something special.
Nobody on base. Inside on Edmonds.
How about that number?
That pitch.
One.
Hit 100 miles an hour.
I mean, there's fastball in, and then there's that one. There's a buzz in this crowd, even though it was a ball over that number.
Back with a slider and missed, and the count is 3-1.
You know, he threw that because he thought Edmonds was guessing fastball, and Jim Edmonds is one of the best guess hitters in baseball. He'll sit on one pitch. He's going to get that pitch now. It's going to be a fastball and by design in the zone because Pujols is on deck.
Fly ball left field, well hit. Ward backing up, now turning around, and it hits the top of the wall. And it's going to be a long single for Edmonds. I mean, that's a Fenway Park green monster kind of single. And that just missed getting out over that yellow line.
I was going to say that's only about one third of that green monster, though. They forgot to extend it. And it was almost a lead that was extended here. Take a look at how close this comes to getting out of the ballpark. That's a great job by the fans to get out of the way of that, not putting an umpire in a difficult position to make that call.
Wow. That pitch that Edmonds ripped almost out of the park, 99 miles an hour. It's a single, and here's Pujols. You got to figure if he throws that pitch 100 miles an hour, assuming Edmonds gets the bat on it, it's going to have a little more lift, maybe an extra foot, maybe it screams out of the park.
Either that or make a deeper dent in that wall. That ball was smoked.
Game of inches. Edmonds runs. The throw by Osmus. Got him. Edmonds called out at second base. An absolute pea tossed down there by Brad Osmus. Edmonds has had a couple of beefs with umpires tonight. He is caught stealing on a very close play. He comes up gunning. He put it right on the bag. Ooh, but it looked like Jim got in there. Well, if Jim Edmonds all of a sudden just comes out of his skin on your screen, you can't blame him. It's been a very frustrating night for him. It looked like, as he was caught stealing moments ago, Rick, that he was safe.
Well, he came within a foot of hitting the baseball out of the ballpark, but when it went for a single, he thought he got his foot in before the tag of Craig Biggio, and I agree with him. That foot is on the bag. The tag actually went down below the knee. Makes a quick peek back. He had a great jump. I think he was amazed that Osmus was even going to make a throw. But not only did Brad make a throw, he made a great, strong throw, a little bit high, but got rid of it so quick that he was able to get the call.
Earlier tonight, a foul tip into the catcher's mitt. He was called out on strikes. The replay showed the ball hit the ground, and he should not have been struck out. Barely missed a home run, as you point out, nailing that one up against the fence just below the yellow line. I mean, that's a tough night. He's also made an error at center field.
Well, that means that Roy Oswalt, Octavio Dotel, and Billy Wagner are out of the game now.
Greg Zahn is in as a pinch batter. He hits in the nine slot against White. We're into the bottom of the ninth of a 2-2 tie. Greg Zahn, a switch hitter, a catcher by trade. Overall hitting 217.
That's the first inning I've ever watched Billy Wagner pitch that he didn't strike somebody out.
But he did hit 100 on the radar gun. One ball and one strike on Zahn, and then it's Brian Hunter and Craig Biggio. And if the inning is still alive, Lance Berkman and possibly Bagwell. And if it gets to Bagwell, you know the Astros are close to celebrating time. White's 1-1 pitch. Fought off, and it's 1-2.
Zahn had a huge double last night, his first at bat in the second inning. Two guys on, two outs. He hit a double down the left field line, putting these Astros right back in that ball game, as we know, eventually winning.
Astros trying to get to it at 4.5 of the Cardinals Central Division lead and really make this thing exciting down the stretch. And they still have 5 games left head to head with St. Louis.
Give me your manager of the year in the National League. You go with the guy in the Cardinal uniform?
Oh, I think he'll get a lot of votes. I'm big on Jim Tracy.
What a good choice.
Especially if the Dodgers make that, losing Kevin Brown. during the course of the season. Of course, they've gotten him back.
I just think about all the losses that Tony La Russa has gone through. I don't mean on the field. Started in spring training the first time without Mark McGwire. Then Ankiel goes down. Injuries to Woody Williams. And that was just the beginning. That was nothing compared to Jack Buck and Daryl Kyle. And a lot of people expected that team to just collapse as far as the standings were concerned.
Tutis on, brushed him back, and the count is full. I think Bobby Cox ought to get a whole lot of consideration as well. And I know everyone looks at Glavine, they look at Maddux, they say, well, right away, you're going to start with two potential 20-game winners. John Smoltz has been remarkable as the closer, but look at that bullpen and how he's managed that bullpen.
I don't even know where Darren Holmes and Chris Hammond have been.
I know.
I know where they're at now.
3-2 from White, and again, a piece for Zahn. He has a walk-off home run this year. There's a grand slam back in June against the Diamondbacks. So look at the standings and a wild card picture as well. And you can see the Astros have a whole lot to play for tonight.
I think that's where their sight is the Cardinals. They don't control what happens with the Dodgers. They do play the Giants.
A three-game series left at the very end of the season against San Francisco. Zahn with a long at bat here. Stokes a foul, but he hit it sharply. He was right with that pitch.
You know, as a manager, Dave, this is exactly what you want. You never know what the result's going to be, but you want this kind of swing. You want him to be aggressive. Try to end this ball game with one swing of the bat. As we mentioned earlier, Billy Wagner's done for the night. Dotel's done. Well, all of a sudden now, that's a big drop-off with whoever it is you bring out of your bullpen.
Another 3-2 pitch to the nephew of Rick Dempsey from the catcher. High fly ball on the right field line, but he hit it foul. He hit it a long way. That got into the upper deck. So Rick White has emptied the bucket. He has shown Zahn everything he can show him. And Zahn is right on him.
You know, if it were me, he wouldn't see another fastball.
Wow.
That ball was about four rows deep in the upper deck.
This is the 10th pitch he's throwing him in this at bat. That's a breaking ball fought off. So thus far, this has been the battle of the game. Ninth inning. Nobody out. 2-2 tie. Zahn the pinch hitter.
You got to get that off-speed pitch down. You got a guy cheating on the fastball like Zahn is. Start something out in the zone, have some late movement down and out of it, and generally they're going to help you. Here comes the slider. See if he gets it down.
3-2 popped up. Back this way. And fouled off, so it's still 3 balls, 2 strikes.
We're not kidding back this way.
Almost into our booth, almost into your lap. Here's the 12th pitch coming to Greg Zahn in the ninth inning. And he struck him out with a fastball up and out of the zone. He whiffs Greg Zahn. One down.
Another big number, 95 miles an hour. Just took the over aggressiveness part of Greg Zahn right out of it. Also took a lot of the volume out of this crowd.
Sure did. Back up to the top of the order now for the Astros, and Brian Hunter has reached base twice tonight. The two best defensive plays in the game belong to J.D. Drew. They both occurred in the same inning, in the fifth. Foul off by Hunter, but Hunter early in the contest made a wonderful sprawling catch deep out there in left center field. Made a diving play.
You know, it's really remarkable the contributions that the Astros have gotten. Brian Hunter stepping up, just being outstanding both offensively and defensively.
Hitting 297 as he fishes and fouls it away. It's 0-2.
Vizcaino stepping into that everyday role and getting it done. I mean, the Astros have done it differently than with the Cardinals. I mean, the Cardinals could afford to go get Roland, to get Chuck Finley. I mean, you know what those guys can do. I don't think even the Astros expected all that they've gotten out of the two guys previously mentioned.
The 0-2 off the plate. Hunter, a guy who's played for six major league clubs. You talked about Vizcaino, another guy who's been around a lot with different teams. Brian Hunter has played for the Tigers, Seattle, Colorado, Cincinnati, Philadelphia, and now here with the Astros. Trying to reach base against the right-hander with one out in the bottom of the ninth. 2-2. Now he gets on. You've got to think about sending him. Even though Jimmy Williams doesn't like to steal bases, Hunter still has excellent speed. Biggio up next. Here's the 2-2. Ball three as it ran in around the hand.
Not only are runs hard to come by in this ball game, but outs are equally as difficult to get. Some tremendous one-on-one battles here in just 8.5 innings that we've played.
Another 3-2 count. On the infield, Vina charging, scoops, got him. Two out. That has the feel of a game headed for extra innings, but we'll see. Biggio certainly has the power to untie it and win it here with one swing.
Well, there's 54 outs in a ball game when it's completed. We've seen 53 of them.
This is the second time that Tom Gordon has warmed up tonight. And Biggio is trying to make sure Jimmy Williams doesn't have to use him tonight. Duncan out to the hill again. We will have SportsCenter as soon as we finish up here in Houston. But this one has to come to an end, and it's tied up 2-2 with two down in the ninth. Nobody on base for Biggio as they chant for him.
Well, they've known this name for a long time.
Been at it 15 years as both an all-star catcher and an all-star second baseman. He doubled in the fifth inning. He was stranded. He's also reached on an error, so he's actually been on base three times. Low for a ball, 2-0.
Watching his approach to Biggio here, it seems like Dave Duncan said, stay away, use the big part of the ballpark. That was a great plan until you miss with those first two pitches, because there's an MVP candidate in the on-deck circle. This is the guy you want to get out.
Lance Berkman up next. A strike, 2-1.
Big pitch. That's that slider that he's so good with. Talked about Jason Simontacchi and how he gets back into the count when he's behind 2-0. You see now how Rick White does it. It'll take a little bit of the sting out of the swing of Craig Biggio here, knowing that he could get that over then.
He is 4-for-10 head to head off White. Now it's 2-2. Both starters turned in gutsy efforts, often pitching with men on base. Jason Simontacchi for St. Louis. Roy Oswalt for the Houston Astros will not win his 20th. and he will not win his 10th consecutive start. So that streak is broken up. Nobody on for the little second baseman. In there for called strike three. Caught him looking. White with some terrific work. He strikes out two in the ninth to push this game to extra innings. DiGio thought it was low, but he's called out. And we're going to 10. Extra innings coming up as we bring you the top half of the 10th inning from Houston and Minute Maid Park. Dave O'Brien, Rick Sutcliffe in extra innings. The Astros are 5-7, and St. Louis with a 4-5 record. The Astros go to the pen, and Tom Flash Gordon will make his 29th appearance. His first 28 were awfully good, Rick.
Well, you know what, Jimmy? Williams did not want to see Flash in this ball game, though. As you mentioned earlier, Dave, he got him up in the sixth inning to possibly bring him in. That's tough on a reliever to sit around that long and then try to get that same intensity and velocity back almost an hour later.
Pujols, Roland, and Martinez. The high water he has to try and wade through. Albert tonight, 1-for-4 with a single. But he, like his mates, has had trouble driving in runs. And we have not had a run scored in the ballgame since the fourth, when the Cardinals tied it up with a pair.
Huge advantage now swings to the side of the St. Louis Cardinals. Mentioned the numbers earlier, 19-6. And Oswalt starts in which he gets the decision. 1-4 the Astros are in the others.
The righty's 1-1 pitch. Hammered into the alley. That's a gap shot. Hunter sprints after it, but still gets by him up against the fence. And Pujols leads off the 10th with a double. His second hit of the ball game.
I think you're going to have to get somebody else up and get him up quickly. That last fastball just 89 miles an hour. When he's right, Flash Gordon is back physically, touching the low 90s, if not mid 90s. But that velocity wasn't there on that pitch. Pujols extends on it. Now it'll be a pinch runner in scoring position as a go-ahead run for the Cardinals.
It'll be Eli Marrero. So they get some pretty good wheels in there.
And you improve defensively in the outfield when you get to the bottom of this inning. So one guy is able to handle two roles.
Look at all these base runners. I mean, 30 base runners, only 4 men have touched home plate. So the Cardinals are thinking something's got to give. And Scott Rolen is the man to give it. He does have an RBI hit tonight. He's 1-for-4. And the first pitch to Scott Rolen is fouled away for strike one. We'd like to welcome those of you who've been watching the Yankees and the White Sox. Rick Sutcliffe, Dave O'Brien from Minute Maid Park here in Houston, Texas. Just a giant game as the Houston Astros try to pull to within 4.5 of the front-running St. Louis Cardinals in the Central. Eli Marrero, the runner at second, he's into the ballgame to run for Albert Pujols, the all-star for the Cardinals, who just doubled into the gap. We're in the 10th inning. Nobody out, and the batter's Scott Rolen. Play on through, right into the outfield. There was no one covering. Marrero into third base, sliding in safely. And a botched play by the Houston Astros. What happened there?
You'll have to ask Flash Gordon. Absolutely no reason to make that throw. I mean, you know, if you don't see a gap between your infielder and the runner, you don't make the throw anyway. This Caeno was just sneaking in to get the attention of Marrero to keep him from possibly stealing third base. Well, Flash Gordon just gives it to him.
Looked like he threw it right between the legs of Eli Marrero. That one almost got him on the foot.
You've got to turn around and see two guys there, and your guy clearly in front to even think about making that throw.
So the infield in as Rolen pops it up. Biggio racing out. Bagwell there in foul ground. Biggio cradles it, and Marrero will stay right there. A big first out as Rolen pops into foul territory. Gordon, who moments ago threw the ball into center field, his first error since 1997. It's a good defensive play.
In the past, Craig Biggio would have let Jeff Bagwell have this all the way, but he knows his buddy's arm is hurting. And I think that if Bagwell would have caught that ball, Jose Oquendo might have tested the sore shoulder of Bagwell. Biggio called him off, and absolutely no chance then.
And SportsCenter coming your way. Tino Martinez is about to be walked intentionally, and the batter will be Edgar Renteria.
I might have done that too.
Well, Tino against Flash Gordon. 11 for 32. That's a batting average of 344. So I'm with you there.
That's more than a trend. That's, yeah. That's not like, you know, 4 for 8 or something like that.
That's right.
That's a lot of history there, and not favorable history for Flash Gordon.
So now Renteria, with his base hit in game 7 of the 97 World Series, won the Florida Marlins a world championship, will come on up to hit. And he's just 1 for 9 against Gordon. So this is a much better matchup for Jimmy Williams and for Flash Gordon.
Well, I imagine you're going to back the infield up, hope that you can make one pitch and get the two outs that you needed via the ground ball double play.
The one thing to keep in mind, if Renteria does not hit it particularly hard, he has 28 infield hits. So he can beat it out at first base. If he were to do that, beat the wrap on a double play, the Cardinals would take the lead. Renteria with an excellent offensive year, hitting 304, and he swings right through it for strike one.
He's about as clutch as they come. I think deep down, if you ask Tony La Russa, obviously he'd start with Pujols, his RBI guy. He'd one up in this spot. But after that, this might be Tony's second choice.
Guerrero at third, Martinez at first. One strike on Renteria. Base hit into left field. Here comes Marrero. He scores. And Renteria cashes in. 3-2 St. Louis. His third hit tonight.
Just amazing to me to think this is the 7th year in the league already for Edgar Renteria. And he just recently turned 27 years of old. Of age, excuse me. He's been doing that since day one, though, and particularly, and you know better than I, in that World Series that he had back in 97 with the Florida Marlins.
Well, he chases in that run, but remember, it was Albert Pujols who doubled. He didn't score the run. Marrero did, because he came in to run for him. But Pujols had the huge hit. And so the Cardinals have the lead for the first time tonight. Pitch inside on Perez. Eduardo Perez hitting with runners at first and second. Still only one out. I mean, it's gotten very, very quiet here in Houston.
Well, don't let that 213 average deceive you. There's been a lot of production there. Eduardo Perez, he's got 30 hits on the year, but 10 of them, as you saw, were homers. 9 of them are doubles. And there's 25 RBIs.
Is Martinez at second, Renteria with a go-ahead RBI single at first. That missed. Two balls and one strike. Is Ringhausen, the right-hander, getting loose for the St. Louis club. And looking for a save opportunity. An Astro loss, and they're back to 6.5 out. That's low for a ball. 3-1 on Perez.
Astro fans not happy with that call. That looked a lot like strike three to Craig Biggio.
Left-hander Pedro Borbón also throwing in the Astro bullpen, but Flash Gordon has given up a double and a single in this 10th inning. Cut on and missed. Full count here. as St. Louis has taken the lead 3-2 in the 10th. And a loss would be devastating for the Astros. Most would tell you they probably had to sweep this series to have a realistic chance of catching this St. Louis club here in September. Strike three, got him looking. He tossed in the hook and buckled the knees of Perez for the second out.
Kind of surprised that Renteria didn't see a hook in any one of the two pitches in his at bat, which gave the Cardinals this lead. Flash Gordon looks to be all the way back. There's some questions physically about him. His velocity back up now. Looks like he's gotten loose finally, but maybe just a little too late for the Astros.
Due up in the bottom of the 10th for Houston. Berkman, Bagwell, and Ward.
Maybe it's not too late.
Yeah. We shall see. Check swing roller right there to Bagwell to retire Matheny. And that's it. But St. Louis takes the lead on the RBI single by Edgar Renteria, but some big lumber coming up. Berkman, Bagwell, Ward on the way to try and even it or take the lead and win it for Houston. St. Louis with a 3-2 lead as we bring you the bottom half of inning number 10. But a chance here for the Astros. And we have SportsCenter on the way with John Anderson and Kevin Frazier. A look at the Wild Wild West. It's been a wacky Friday the 13th. And the Cowboys are still in shock here in Texas. All that coming up on SportsCenter, and also more from Minute Maid Park, where St. Louis is trying to put at least one nail into the coffin of the Houston Astros, trying to knock them back to 6.5 out in the Central. The closer, Jason Isringhausen, is in. He's been awfully good. A 2.39 ERA, and he's appearing in his 56th game. Tony La Russa.
Well, you see 15 walks, so you wouldn't expect that here in this inning. You see also 41 hits, but none of those have left the ballpark. So statistically, if Houston's going to get back in this game, they're going to have to put together two or three hits here in the bottom of the 10th.
Tough part of the order, though. It's going to be Lance Berkman, followed by Jeff Bagwell, and then Darryl Ward's scheduled. Berkman just 0 for 4 in his career off Isringhausen. Bagwell's done a lot better. And we'll see what develops here in the bottom of the 10th. Three runs on 11 hits, two errors for St. Louis. And for the Astros, two runs, eight hits, and one error.
That's the way it should be.
Absolutely. And it's what you expect from two teams who are playing their best baseball of the year right now. The Cardinals had won 8 in a row coming into the series. They lost last night. And that gave the Astros 14 wins in their last 17 games with that victory. So here we go. Here's Berkman. And he takes ball one. Lance in the game is 1 for 2, a single and a ground out. In between, he's walked twice.
Well, they've had the shift on all night with Berkman, but it kind of surprises me with a guy that throws as hard as Isringhausen does.
And it's lined right through where the shortstop would have been. A base hit. They shifted over. Renteria was not there. And Berkman has his second hit. And the tying run is on in the 10th with nobody out.
This guy throws real hard. Berkman is not a dead ball type guy. He'll go to the opposite field, particularly when you've got a guy that throws as hard as Isringhausen does. Isringhausen also doesn't have the command in and out of that fastball that the starting pitcher, Jason Simontacchi, had. He missed his location on the inner half, and Berkman made him pay for it.
Now I mentioned Jeff Bagwell's had more success against Isringhausen. He's 4 for 8 against him. Swinging a high fly ball to right field, but Drew with room behind him to make this catch. One down. Remember earlier in the ball game, Drew had to leap up against the fence and steal a 3-run homer from Bagwell. This one didn't travel nearly as far. One out.
Had me thinking it was going to go as far, maybe even further, but just off the end of the bat. Could have been an unbelievable night for Jeff Bagwell had it not been for J.D. Drew.
Well, the Astros aren't dead yet. Ward is 1 for 3 with an RBI single. Ward at first base. A chopper sharply hit. Vina to Renteria. One on the first. Double play. And the ball game is over. St. Louis has won it in 10 innings by a final of 3-2. And a crushing loss for the Astros. They fall to 6.5 out in the Central. The Cardinals turning four big double plays in that contest. But J.D. Drew came up with the huge catch to save three runs. The defensive star of the game. The final score from Minute Maid Park in Houston. St. Louis 3 and the Astros 2. More coming up during SportsCenter, which is next. For Rick Sutcliffe and our entire ESPN crew, I'm Dave O'Brien. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.